Gentlemen, and welcome to WDSU TV's coverage of Delaware State University Hornet football. We're back again for another season as the Hornets kick off their home schedule today against the 1-1 Shawan Hawks, and the Hornets come in at 0-2. Shawan is in D2, the Hornets are in D1. This will be an interesting matchup of two teams, especially the Hornets looking for a win. It is Hall of Fame day here at Alumni Stadium. Back once again with Derek Slayton. My name is Byron Dixon. Today's matchup puts the Hornets, who are coming to the day, they're trying to bounce back from a 45-13 loss against Kent State. The Hornet offense was unable to get on track in the contest, recording negative total yardage in the game. The Hornets were credited with minus 38 rushing yards on 28 attempts. The figure included negative 46 yards on 7 sacks. The Kent State defense really got after quarterback Isaiah Obadu. DSU completed just 3 of 10 passes for 5 yards, and the Hornets scored each of their 2 touchdowns on defense. Safety Kevin Johnson forced a fumble on a run, and DSU cornerback William Burton picked the ball off in the air and ran 35 yards for a touchdown. Kent State led 45-6 when the Hornet defense scored the second time in the game. Free safety Tarek Colston scooped up a KSU fumble and darted 70 yards to the end zone with 7:18 left to play. The Hornets did lose the game, but we're going to get ready to look at today's game. The Hornets have a great shot to get that first win of the season. And we look to see what they will do against Shawan Hawks to come in as a D2 team. And I'm going to get ready to turn it into the hands of my color commentator, Derek Slayton, who will give his keys to the game and his impact players and some things he's looking at for the day's game.
Thank you, Byron. In terms of impact players on the offensive side, like you mentioned, it's going to be Obado, dual threat quarterback, who has a rushing touchdown so far in the season, but has 0 passing touchdowns. he has to get this offense started, and he has to get the ball out of his hands a little quicker, as he had 7 sacks on him last game. In terms of defense, Tarik Colston, he talked about the fumble recovery. He returned for 72 yards. He has 4 career touchdowns, 2 off of interceptions, a blocked punt for a return, and a fumble for return for a touchdown. So he's definitely a playmaker. And he was a defensive player of the week for the MEAC. And for Shawin Hawks, offensively, they have a terrific quarterback in Randall Dixon, who has completed 69% of his completions of his passes, and also has 376 yards through the air for 4 touchdowns. Defensively, they have a good defensive back as well in Roderick Lindsay. He had 4 interceptions on the season last year. He's second on the team in tackles, and he's first on the team in pass defense. And for the keys of the game, the Hornets have to control the line of scrimmage. They've allowed 11 sacks on offense and only have 1 sack for themselves on the defense. So they have to do a better job of getting pressure and also keeping players off of Obito. Secondly, they have to have a balanced offense. They only have 2 yards of rushing this entire season. A lot of that has to do because of the sacks. So once again, control the offensive line of scrimmage and you won't have as many sacks and you're able to get a little bit more yards on the ground. And finally, they have to convert on third downs. They're only converting 21% of the time. In order to do that, have a balanced attack. Be able to get some positive yards on first and second down, making third down easier.
Thank you for those impact players and those keys to the game, Derek. It'll definitely be interesting to see. And I think one thing we saw a lot of last year, the defensive ability, and starting at the beginning of this year, defensive ability to put points on the board and create opportunities for the offense. It'll be up to Asai Obado, back from the back injury, to see what they can do. As we talked about, controlling the line of scrimmage, having balance on offense, converting on third downs. And I think that starts with being able to run the football effectively, whether with the running backs, Jamal Jackson, Dae-Young Chong, or even Obado himself. Derek, I think another key point that we didn't mention is special teams. Last year, it killed us. Can you talk a little bit about what Jeremiah Magayu and this team could do as they get ready for kickoff real quick?
Yeah, we always mentioned special teams last year because it was such an issue. From just getting a snap off to making a field goal or even kicking the ball off, they've struggled. They had a lot of punts were blocked last season. So in order to do that, they brought some starters to play on the special teams. We talked about Colston. He has one of his returns from a blocked punt. So they like to use him on both sides of the football. Well, not on offense, but on special teams. So using your starters, your best players on a special team should help them a lot as we're about to start off the kickoff.
Hornets will receive the kick from Shawan University. Kicker is number 99, Nick Hahula, the big fella. It's 5'10", 250, one of the biggest kickers I've ever seen. We're ready for football, ladies and gentlemen, and the kick is off. Kick goes to about out of the hands, actually. And it'll be a touchback for the Hornets as they'll get the ball on the 20 to start it. And Isaiah Obado comes out for the offense. Derek, what are you looking for at this offense early on?
I want to see Obado get the ball out of his hands a little quicker. He's had a tendency to hold on to the ball, and a lot of quarterbacks who are mobile hold on to the ball a little too long, thinking they can make a play with their legs, and it hasn't worked for him a whole lot this season. For 11 sacks, that's just not what you want for a quarterback, especially someone coming off of a back injury.
Hornets already have their receivers outside of the huddle, offensive line breaks huddle, and Obado will come out, looks like, in an empty set. Early on, 2 receivers to his left, 1 in motion. Ball at the 20. And the ball is fumbled on the first play, and Obado falls right on it. Not the way you want to start there, Derek.
It was a different look. Wanted to see what's going to happen. Looked like they had Allen on a reverse, but that's not a good way to start the game. They got to do a better job of execution. Clearly, bad play.
Second and 14, 14:40 remaining. We're scoreless. Second play of the game from scrimmage. Ball stays on the 20-yard line. Obado comes out in the same empty set. Ready for the snap. He gets it. Looks to his left. Throws to his left. Pass is caught. Tries to break the tackle, but gets to nowhere. About a gain of 1. And that looks like that is going to be Bryson Allen on the catch.
Obado has to get that ball out with a little bit more strength. Kind of just had it floating in the air, and the defense was able to react very quickly to that.
Definitely don't want to set your receiver up like that, and it could lead to an interception. Obado, 3 wide receivers to his right, 1 to his left. Ball on the 21. Takes the snap. Looks right. It's going to go across the middle. Pass is dropped, but he took a big hit there. And that was number 86, Kamal Abrams, Didn't hear those footsteps there, but he felt it.
One of our keys to the game was convert on third downs, but when you have a fumble on first down and only 1 yard on second down, you end up in these third and long situations, and that's a catch Abram should make, but you're putting your offense in a bad situation when you're third and 12.
Jeremiah Magayu comes out for the punt, and now the Hornets shifting of the line here. Magayu was one of the bright spots for the Hornets last year, and he'll look to get off to a great start here today. Punt is a screwball, but it's got a little carry to it. Stays there, takes a Shawan bounce, and the Hornets need to get that ball. They do, and it looks like that will be at the 37-yard line. Shawan and quarterback Randall Dixon will come out with their first possession of the day.
Kind of a weird formation, but at least it kept the punt block from getting to McCullough. That's something we've talked about in the past, so good job by the Hornets on special teams. And
I'm sure Coach Carter knows he has to do something to prevent those blocks as we get a look here at the Hornets starters on offense and defense. Shawan and quarterback Randall Dixon. I like that last name, ladies and gentlemen. I wonder why. Shotgun has a man, gives it to him. It's number 24, runs left. And he's carrying about three Hornet defenders. Gain of about 9. They may give him 10. Might be a first down. So it'll be a gain of 9. Second and 1. Ball on the 45. Shawan actually gets the first down. Throw to the right. He's going to do a quarterback pass. And he has a man wide open. And that pass is completed at the 20-yard line. A little trickeration there. And that pass is caught by Kane Lombard. Derek, a little trickeration on the first drive. Take some guts.
Exactly what the Hawks want to do. You're the underdog. You're the Division II team. So take a risk. Good job with the trick play there. But the Hornets have to be more disciplined on that play.
Usually you see this defense more disciplined as you see Shawan in a shotgun. Ball on the 20. Four wide receiver set. Dixon. Got the snap, looks left. Throws it in the middle, has a man. That is caught, and he gets inside of the 5, and that's going to be a first and goal. And that pass was caught by number 18, Damian Ellis.
Terrible start for the Hornets defense, normally the bright spot of this team. Somebody's going to have to make a play because the Chowan Hawks haven't scored a first down, our first quarter touchdown all season long.
Great point there. They haven't scored one. They're looking to score one here, and they have a great opportunity. Dixon, two running backs behind him in a shotgun, hands it off, and that's going to be a touchdown for Shawan, and they strike first. And just like that, Derek, Shawan has the first points of the day in an effective opening drive. What do you think about that?
That was a great job by Chowan Hawks. Executed a trick play perfectly, and that was the key moment of that drive. For the Hornets, they're coming out and looking a little sluggish, not a lot of energy on either side of the ball, and has to be attributed to the offensive failures. The defense sees their team mess up again on offense and has to be a little deflating early on.
Shawan lines up for the point after. Kick is up. Kick is good. And there is Nick Hahula once again. And Shawan leads the Hornets 7-0 in a drive that took under 3 minutes. With 12:28 left in the first quarter, the Hornets will try again on offense. Once again with Derek Slayton, I'm Byron Dixon. WDSU TV's Hornet coverage. Hall of Fame Day here at Alumni Stadium. First game of our broadcast schedule. Derek, what does the offense have to do here?
I would like to see them establish the run game. First play, it looked like it would have been a reverse for a run, but didn't work out that well. Let's get the ball. Let's do some more traditional sets if you're the Hornets. Hand the ball up to Jackson on the first down, see if he can get you some positive yards, make it a little easier for Opodo to make some completions and get the ball moving.
Well, Derek, we talked a little bit about the defense of the Hornets. That was a little uncharacteristic of them. What do you think that Coach Carter will talk to them about as you see him in the huddle with them now? He's a leader of men, and what is he going to tell his team here? A lot of them young.
They have to just have a short memory on that drive. It was a bad drive. A good trick play caught them off guard, but they have to just let that go, be more disciplined on the second possession, and whatever offense does, whether it's good or bad, don't let that affect them into playing sluggish like they did on the first possession.
So we're ready for Shawan to kick the ball back to the Hornets. They'll get that second possession of the day. Ahula will kick off from the 35. As you see, Obado, Jamal Jackson, Eric Scott, Kamal Abrams, and Nate Ortiz, Searles, Helwig, Mangone, Izau, and Hill round out the starters for the Hornets. Ball is lined on the tee. As it's once again 7-0, Shawan striking first. A little trickery with the wide receiver pass. And it kicks off deep into the end zone. Eric Scott takes it, and he will down it wisely for the touchback. Well, Derek, what are you looking for in this second drive? We talked about converting on third downs. What do you have to do here?
They have to get some positive yards in these first two downs, whether it's 2 or just 3 yards, something to make it 3rd and 5 or 3rd and 4 for Obado to make a better play than having to throw on 3rd and 12 and having pressure and overthrowing receivers like we've seen in the last two games. So get some positive yards, do some plays that you know is extremely successful, whether it's a handoff or a short slant route or anything to get some momentum going.
Question is, can they get the running game going? They had negative yards last week. A credit to all those sacks, but Obado comes out again in a shotgun. Coach Carter looking to spread the field a little bit. 3 wide receivers. Running back to his right, Jamal Jackson. Looks like it was given to him, and that is going to get nowhere. He is swallowed up immediately, and no protection there for the running back.
I did want to see them run the ball, but I don't understand running a draw on first down, which is normally a running situation. Normally teams are waiting for the run on first down, so the draw put Jackson in a bad position. It didn't fool anybody.
Good point there. And that defensive line of Shawan has some big rough riders up front that definitely look to clog the middle. As Obado, Hornets not really huddling as much, using a lot of motion and shotgun. It looks like it'll be 2 wide receivers to his left, 1 to his right. Eric Scott, the bottom of your screen. Maybe they take a shot here to him with 1-on-1 coverage. Obado looks, has Scott, doesn't throw to him. Pass is complete through the middle. That is going to be number 85, Nate Ortiz, right up the middle, and that will set up 3rd down, ladies and gentlemen.
Good job by Ortiz sitting in the middle of that zone wide open and giving himself a good, easy target for Obado to make the pass. And good job by the offensive line giving him a clean pocket, was able to step in, read through his progressions, and make a decent play.
Definitely something we didn't see a lot of last year, a lot of tight end action. Good to see it here, especially occupying the middle of that field as Obado calls out the play at the line. 3 wide receivers, Jamal Jackson to his left. Ortiz looking to block as well. 3rd down and 1. Throw to Jackson for the screen. Has some brigade of blockers. Makes the guy miss. Runs left. And he'll get about to about the 45-yard line. Good play call there on 3rd down, Derek.
And that's a good job. Teams know that the Hornets have struggled in pass protection. So what do? Let them all come in and throw the screen over top of their heads. And a very easy play for them to get that 1st down. Good job, and that's what happens when you have 3rd and 1s and 3rd and 2s. You're able to use plays like screens to get some yardage and get the 1st down.
Great point there, 3rd manageable. Anything under 3rd and 5, you look at a manageable down, and you look in your plays and say we have to be able to convert consistently if you want to move the ball and eventually score some points. The Hornets do that very well there. It looks like we have a penalty call. And it looks like that's going to be, we didn't exactly hear the call, but it's going to be a 15-yard penalty. It'll set the Hornets back. And just like that, the Hornets are moving backwards.
Probably a personal foul. Trying to see who that's against. But that's not what you want when you get the 1st down. I mean, pretty stupid play by whoever committed the personal foul. Didn't get the number, though.
So that will, they will replay the down. So it will be 1st down. They did give them the 1st down. They just moved them back 15 yards. 11:02 remaining. Shawan leads 7-0. Obado, 2 wide receivers to his right. Ortiz to his left. And has Jamal Jackson in the backfield. Obado runs right. Throws it right. Has it to Golson. Nice solid game now, 1st down.
Golson has to elevate his game to become the number one receiver with Milton Williams gone now. So good to see him in action early. Good job by Obado on a rollout, finding Golson in the slot. Good pass. And now we've got second and four. It's manageable, and this is what we've been talking about.
Second and about three. Second and three. 10:28 remaining, and the Hornets are moving the ball a little bit here. Obado is in the shotgun. Jackson behind him. Man in motion. Obado fakes, throws. Jackson has some room. Runs right, makes the guy miss, cuts inside. Uses the juke move and gets out to the 45-yard line. Nice gain there on second down, Derek. And once again, the offense is rolling.
And that's not a traditional type of run play, but that's basically like a long handoff to Jackson. I was confused a little bit of what was going on, but great job by Obado keeping your play alive and finding Jackson on that swing route.
Definitely looked like it could have been an option play, but it looks like Jackson had the awareness and sense of mind to not stay in the backfield, but run out, help his quarterback out, and get open. As you see Obado with two running backs behind him. Man in motion. Has it. Looks right. Has Eric Scott on the Carroll route, but he overthrew him and missed it.
That's a good read, but Obado just has to take his time and set his feet and make a better pass. Good job anticipating, because he threw that before Scott even finished his route, which you're supposed to do, but just a little wide.
If he makes that throw, Scott has room and couldn't make guys miss. Hornets in the out formation. Ball is given to Jackson. Excuse me, that's not Jackson. That is Bryson Allen making guys miss, looking like a little Darren Sproles there and hiding under the offensive line and making the defense miss, Derek.
And Bryson Allen is a person they can use as a receiver in a slot or as a running back, and normally it's more of a faster guy, but was able to break a whole bunch of tackles.
Hornets in the out formation again. Probably will give it to Allen again. They do. He runs right, cuts through, gets a gain of about 2 yards as the ball will move to the 30-yard line, and the Hornets have some momentum as we set up second down and seven with 9:25 remaining. Shawan leading 7-0.
These are the positive yards that we've been talking about. Much better drive this time, getting their first downs and controlling the possession of the game. Let's see what they can do here on second and seven.
As you see, Obado looks to his coordinator, looks to his teammates to get the call. Hornets in the out formation again. Give it to Allen. That's Jamal Jackson back in, excuse me. He gets a gain of about three as the ball moves to about 25-yard line. It sets up about a third and two with 8:55 remaining.
We've been talking a lot about the skill players, but the offensive line, this possession is doing a good job creating running lanes, and when they're passing it, giving Obado a lot of time. They're doing a great job controlling the line of scrimmage so far.
Good job to see the offensive line in unison. They are a young group, but it's time for them to mature if this team wants to take the next step. Obado, Jackson behind him. Ortiz in motion. Golson to his far left. Tosses it to Jackson. Jackson cuts inside, nowhere to go, and he is stuffed. May have gotten back to the line of scrimmage, maybe a gain of one, but that's going to set up fourth down. And Derek, what do you do here?
I think you take the points here, but they might actually go for it. I'm not 100% sure. On that play, I would like to see Obado check down to a pass. They had 10 people in the box, but he never made that adjustment as they're getting the play from Carter from the sideline to go for it. Let's see what they can do here.
You know what I like to call it? New coach, take a risk, see what your offense can do, see what your quarterback can do, and put faith in some, instill some sort of confidence, and see. And if they do, don't get it, the defense, they have to go a long field to score. Obado, shotgun, looks left, looks right, has time, scrambles right, has some space, he's going to run with it, has some space, makes a guy miss, cuts inside, spins, carries a few more Shawan defenders with him, and that is a big-time game, but it looks like the ball is out, and he fumbled. And Shawan recovered. And that's going to be number 23, Jarius Cook, on the fumble force. And 26, Roderick Lindsay on the recovery. Wow, Derek, what happened there?
I was thinking the entire time as he's running, I hope he gets down. I hope he gets down, because they're really not going after you. They're going after that football. And spitting in traffic like that is not a great job, because you know one hit is going to knock that football out. Has to do a better job on the next possession protecting the ball.
Great point. We saw that the other night in the Denver Kansas City game. Jamal Charles with the fumble. And Obado not really putting the ball away high and tight. And they got in there, like you said, and went after that ball as Dixon comes out in a little bit of a pistol formation. Ball at the eight. Throws it left. Has a guy. He carries him for about two more yards. And that is going to be completed to Kane Lombard on a reception. Gain of about 2 yards. 7:15 remaining.
Simple play, trying to just get some space. Got Golson on that completion, and he was able to carry Tariq Colson for a couple of yards. So good job for getting about seven, actually. They're going to give him a lot of yards. I thought they blew the whistle before he gained those extra couple yards, but second down and three.
Dixon in the pistol. Three wide receivers. Runs a little reverse, a little trickeration again. Ball is given off to Tyree Lee, and he gets a nice gain, and that's going to be a first down for Shawan.
Once again, not keeping containment on that side. The whole right side of that defensive line just crashed in on a run, and a reverse on the backside left them exposed there for a 17-yard gain.
Shawan with first down, ball on the 29-yard line. Shawan in a shotgun again, as we've seen a lot from this team. Dixon waiting for the snap, gets it, has a man in motion. Five again, Tyree Lee. Rumbles and bumbles ahead for a gain of about four as it sets down a second down to manage.
One of the big questions coming in for the Hornets was on that defensive line with Rodney Gunter now on the pros. Besides Gabe Sherrod, who on that defensive line is going to make a play? Have not seen it so far in this game.
Great point there, Derek. I agree with you. The line has to be able to get pressure and keep contained. Dixon has 24. Anthony Prince in motion. But he keeps it himself, gives it to Lee. Lee with the juke move, but jukes himself out of his shoes. But a big gain there, and another first down for Shawan.
And after that reverse worked on the first time, then they put a man in motion. Defense keyed on him, and Tyree Lee just gets the ball right up the middle. So Shawan Hawks just toying with the Hornets defense with these formations.
A lot of formations the Hornets probably didn't see in that film study or weren't prepared for. And they have another first down, and they're moving this ball. 5:50 remaining in the first quarter, 7-0. Shawan with the lead and the ball, driving again as they cross midfield at the 49-yard line. Dixon gets the snap, hands it to Lee. Lee runs right, moves ahead for a gain of about four, maybe five. Second down and five for Shawan.
And on each play, you're seeing the offensive line push the Hornets 4 or 5 yards back off the ball. Somebody's going to have to make a play, or they're going to have to start crowding the box and forcing them to throw the ball some more.
Shawan, second. That's going to be second down and seven. 5:10 remaining. Dixon in the shotgun. Two receivers. To his left, one to his right. Two running backs in the backfield. Gets a snap. Hornets bring a little pressure. Dixon has time, steps up. Lee wide open in the flat. Hornets didn't do their job there. And he makes a guy miss again. And this Lee sure is shifty. And he gets a big gain as Shawan moves closer to the red zone.
Tyree Lee might need some new cleats, though. He keeps falling after he makes a nice cutback move. Might have had the touchdown if he didn't fall on that play. But busted coverage by the Hornets. Somebody has to get out on that running back in the flat.
Big gain on the play, 24 yards. Just that sound. First and 10, 20-yard line, and Shawan moves inside the red zone. 4:35 remaining. It looks like we get a timeout for the Hornets. Well, Derek, in this timeout, what has been going on with this Hornets defense early on in this game? A lot of trickeration. What did they do to stop it?
I think they just need to be more disciplined. They had 12 people on the field, and that's the reason for the timeout. Looked like Whittingham didn't know that he was supposed to be on the field and was coming running off so they wouldn't get the penalty. But they just look confused, like they don't know what the plays are called. You're seeing a lot of late shift by the defense. They need to know what the play is, and maybe Carter needs to simplify it for them for this game so they can just react and not have to think as much as they're doing.
That's a great point, Derek, and I think you see a lot of things the Hornets don't practice for on a week-to-week basis, and a lot of players on the Shawan team that people may not know about, but these are qualified guys. Real quickly, can you just talk a little bit about what that fumble, a momentum stopper like that on a drive, can do?
We talked about the defense not being sluggish and being demoralized off of turnovers on the offensive side, but that's exactly what happens. A team... The Hornets had the ball for 8-9 minutes. You're thinking, well, we're at least going to get a field goal and end up fumbling the ball after a nice 15-yard run by Opodo. It's gut-wrenching. It hurts a little bit because they made it such a good play. They were doing so well to come up scoreless, and now the defense once again has to try to bail them out, but once again they're failing.
Shawan with the ball at the 20. First down and 10. 4:29 remaining. Shawan already has the lead, but they're looking to add points to it. and have a great opportunity here as they line up in the red zone ball at the 20-yard line. Dixon in the shotgun again. That's all we've seen Shawan in today. Man in motion. Handoff goes to 29, Reginald Williams, and he's going to be stopped after a gain of about 1 yard.
Good job finally making a play look like it was early, making the play on a tackle, and they're going to have to kind of find some way to make a stop and force a field goal. They should play more aggressively, in my opinion, send some players after these running backs and force them to make a play through the air.
Dixon ball at the 18-yard line. Four wide receivers. Hornets looking to bring some pressure, and they have a man jump off sides, and I think they got him. And that looks like it's going to be on number 88, Gabriel Sherrod. It's going to be offside, so that gives Shawan a 5-yard penalty. Derek, when you're going bad like this, you can't add penalties onto that.
Exactly, and that's sort of a lucky break for the Hornets that they caught that play dead. Normally, they let the offsides be a free play for the offense, and they were going to take a shot. They knew that play was that penalty was on the Hornets, but luckily, the refs called the ball dead.
Second down and 3:37 remaining. Dixon with three wide receivers to his left. He may go that way. He's going to take it himself. He's going to run left. Carries a few defenders inside and a gain of about 6 as he moves into inside the 10.
The Hawks are running the ball very easily, but yet for some reason the Hornets are having two deep safeties. Even though the Hawks are in a shotgun, they're looking to run first. So I don't understand why they're not loading the box up some more to help these linemen out and stopping the run.
Shawan, ball at the 8-yard line. First and goal. Dixon tries to do it again, but he is stuffed. Great job there by the defensive line, Derek, and it looks like they answered your call. They rose to the occasion and got in the backfield that time.
Good job. Looked like Sherrod was in that play as well, the former tight end turned defensive end with the play. And that's what happens when you send some blitzes, an A-gap blitz right up the middle, and Malik Harris and Gabe Sherrod were able to make the play on that ball. Just bring some pressure. Help your defensive line out. Stack the box. Force them to throw this ball in the air.
Shawan, second and goal. Ball is at the 11-yard line. Shawan with the snap. Dixon gets it. Has time. Throws it to the end zone. Guy comes back to the ball, and that is caught for a touchdown, and that's going to be number 6, Anthony Elliott, on a play there. What a play there, Derek, on a touchdown.
Gamble just did not know where the football was. If he turns around, that's an interception, but he just did not have any clue where the ball was. They got pressure on the quarterback. They forced him to make a throw. It wasn't really a great one, but bailed out by Gamble not being aware on that play.
Definitely just chucked it up and hoped the receiver can make a play. If you're a corner, you got to put your head on the ball. Get that head turned around. Find the football. Didn't do it there, and as you see a result, touchdown, Shawan. Kick is up. Kick is good, and Shawan has a 14-0 lead. Nick Hahula with 2:21 remaining in the first quarter. Delaware State trails Shawan 14-0. Well, Derek, what are you going to do now?
They have to simplify the defense because – even on that last touchdown play, it looked like a blown coverage, like Gamble did not know that was his man in coverage, or maybe they were in zone when everybody else was in man. So they have to communicate better on both sides of the football. They don't know what the play is. They don't know where they're supposed to be. A lot of missed assignments. And a team that should not be up 14-0 has shocked everybody in this crowd, and it's not looking good so far.
That's why they play the game, Derek. I mean, just because the team is in Division II or a lower class doesn't mean they're not going to get up and play hard and isn't well coached and has athletes that maybe have been rejected by bigger programs that want to come in here and make a message in a situation like this in the home opener.
Exactly. You're exactly right. And the Hornets cannot overlook anybody on the schedule. They're a team that's trying to build. They're a team that's trying to learn. They're a team that's trying to have some type of foundation. So you have to play every game like it's a MEAC conference game. And they have not come out with that energy, especially on the defensive side. The defensive side last year was a team that was the anchor of the team. But so far, they've shown no leadership, no heart, and they got to get it together if they want to make a comeback.
how Hula will kick the ball off again, something he's done a lot of early on in his first quarter. Hornets ready to receive. Scott back deep, joined alongside Bryson Allen. Kick deep. And Scott will get it in his own end zone. He'll bring it out. Going to run right, has some space, gets nowhere, and he is stopped by number 24, Anthony Prince. Great stop there on special teams.
The Towhan Hawks just have so much confidence. It's showing on every play right there, and everybody on the Hawks is flying down the field. Everybody's feeling good. The Hornets have to make some type of play to get the momentum on their side, to get their bench fired up, to get the players fired up, to make something happen.
It is a long game, though. We're still in the first quarter. Three more four quarters to go, Derek. Hornets with first and 10. Obado will be in a shotgun, goes in Obado, figuring out the play. Looks like they figured it out. He's ready for the snap. He gets it. Pressure coming off the right side. Pass there to Scott, and Scott took his eye off the ball. Simple as that. And easy play turns into an incompletion.
Looked like the refs missed an offside as Dakota Bear got a terrific jump on the line, or he was in the backfield before he was allowed to, but it didn't matter anyway. A drop pass there, they got to do a better job.
Ball will stay on the 15-yard line with 2:10 remaining. Obado will stay in that shotgun. They've used a lot today. Gets it, hands off. Jackson runs through the middle, gets a gain of about 2, maybe 3, and I've set up a third and about 7, Derek. So you're in that third long opportunity. Do they bring pressure, Shawan?
I think they will bring some pressure. Once again, the Hornets have allowed 11 sacks on the season so far. So it would make sense, but the Hornets, they have to do, they have to get this first down. They have to get their defense some breaks because they have to, on the defensive side, get some communication problems fixed. So don't want to have a 3-and-out here.
Third down and 7. Obado takes the snap, looks left, throws left, and that pass is way underthrown of his intended receiver. Number 89, Jeremiah Williams. And Derek, last thing we wanted to see was a 3-and-out, especially in their own territory, and you get it here and they have to punt.
And that was a great play call because Williams had room to make that completion and have a few yards after it, but Obado has to make that throw. It's an easy throw, easy curl route to your receiver. Just put that right on the numbers and allow him to run for it. I don't understand why all of his curl routes that he's thrown has been so wide of the receiver so far.
It looks like Shawan has a great opportunity now of getting the ball past midfield. The Hornets come out in those formations to do anything to try to prevent a block punt. McGayu will look to drive it deep. That punt looks like it might have been partially blocked, but it wasn't. It'll take a Shawan bounce. And bounce, actually take a bounce for the Hornets and go to about the 46-yard line where Dixon and his crew will start their next possession as we close out at the end of the first quarter with 1:18 remaining.
The Hornets defense has to be the aggressor here. They got to bring pressure on that run. They have to force some long third downs and make them beat them through the air again. But also on the defensive end, on the defensive backfield, they have to have better communication on who is covering who. This is a huge possession. Don't want to be down 21 points in the first quarter.
That's the thing. This first quarter seems like it has been going on forever. And Shawan still has a shot to possibly put up even more points as they have the ball at the 46-yard line. Dixon in the shotgun. Run left. He has a blocker. Patiently waits for it. Gets it. And a gain of about 9, Tyree Lee. And this play call has had the Hornets off balance all day.
I wonder if the Hornets knew if this team was going to come out on so many option plays. They look like they're caught off guard by all of them because they're running so many different looks at them in this option, and they have to find a way to control the edges. They're getting beat on the edges, and that's why the option run's been so successful.
Ball on the 45. They're into Hornet territory. Dixon in the shotgun. Dixon hands it off. That's going to be Lee again. and he gets a gain of about 3 yards. And 105 remaining in the first quarter.
Good tackle there by Tizard, even though it was a first down. If he doesn't make that tackle and bring Lee to the ground, Lee might still be running. So good job there. Setting the edge has to be a priority for them.
Dixon, ball at the 42. Hornets making adjustments on the defensive line. Dixon fakes the handoff to Lee. Throws it. Has a man, and what a throw there. Antoine Hicks on a reception and a big gain there.
And once again, Gamble got beat on a coverage. I would like to see if they're going to bring some pressure. I would rather see the Hornets sit back in zone because the ball is being lofted up there for anybody to go get it. It's just the Hornets are getting beat off the line so quickly they can't make a play on the football.
Third and 16 on the play, first and 10, 26 yard line. 30 seconds remaining. First quarter coming to an end. Shawan still has the ball. Dixon hands off to Lee. Lee runs right. Tries to hurdle a guy, but is brought down in the secondary by William Burton. And that'll get the ball to the 19-yard line. And they're in the red zone again. 15 seconds remaining.
The Hornets are just struggling with the option. Once again, they thought that was going to be Dixon running it, and they all ran towards him. And Lee right up on that right side once again. But it looks like we have an injured player on the field trying to see who that is.
And we got an injury timeout, and it looks like it's Lee on the ground. And that's the last thing Shawan wants to see, Tyree Lee on the ground, one of that big play makers and has been a big part of this game early on.
I think that's – is that number six or number five? I think that's Elliott, number six. Or is it – can't see it from the booth, but it doesn't look good. He tried to get up and then crumple back down to the floor. A huge loss, whoever it is, but he looks like he's in some pain.
Couldn't quite see what happened on the play there, but he's slow to get up. And the training staff is definitely tending to him. Well, Derek, we got 13 seconds remaining here in the first quarter. What has stood out to you so far as this quarter comes to a close?
What stood out to me is that how the Hawks are running different formations, but there's really simple plays. They really, even though they kind of make it look option type of runs, we've rarely seen Dixon actually keep it himself and take off. It's really just handoffs and a shotgun. So they have to do a better job of control the running back first. And then if Dixon starts beating you, you worry about that. But control the running back and keep him from killing you in the option runs.
Well, Derek, there have been some new additions to Alumni Stadium, our replay board. What can that do for guys like us, or does it mean anything?
It doesn't mean anything for us because we're in a booth and we can't really see the replay board, but it does a lot for the fans. They had the intros that look great. They did a good job editing that. I wonder if we did that. I'm not 100% sure who edited the videos, but it looked terrific. And I like the addition of the board because it's kind of interactive, and it gets the crowd involved more. It would be a huge asset. Also, we have Blake here, who did the basketball game so well, as one of the announcers, in-game announcers. He's here and trying to get the fans up off their feet some more, trying to get some more support for the football team. So a lot of additions. Of course, that board's huge, but I'm a fan of Blake. I like what he does on the in-games.
And as you said, it looks like Lee has helped off the field. It looks like he may have a questionable return, but we'll get more information when we find out. So could be a potential big loss for this team. And it looks like that'll be the end of the first quarter as the Hornets trail 14-0. Shawan is up. Two early touchdowns, and this offense has been moving. The Hornet defense hasn't really been able to stop anybody. Once again, WDSU TV has all of your coverage of Hornet football this season. Joined alongside Derek Slayton, my name is Byron Dixon. We're back here once again. Well, Derek, have a little break in between quarters. What do the Hornets have to do as we head into halftime, try to build some momentum?
They have to set the edge on the runs. They're getting beat on the runs. They're getting no penetration off the on the defensive line. And that was one of the things we talked about. Control the line of scrimmage. If you can control the line of scrimmage, you don't really have to worry about who's running the football because you're going to meet them in the backfield. But they're getting pushed off the line too easy. When they've brought pressure, they've had breakdowns in the back end. Gamble had a breakdown. They had a breakdown on a trick play that led to a 50-yard completion. So they have to be disciplined on the back end, and they have to be able to get some pressure and get some tackles for losses, to get them out of rhythm. Every single play on first down has been a five-yard gain, and then second down, five-yard gain. So they've been able to move the chains relatively easy, and if the Hornets don't make a play here, then this game can get out of hand.
Definitely could, and we saw that a lot last year. Getting in early holes and just running out of time, essentially, when they finally did figure it out. And Coach Carter has to definitely early on set that tone of being that coach that isn't going to allow a team to get too far gone, lose their confidence. And it looks like, speaking of confidence, Shawan has a lot of it. Talk a little bit about their journey here.
I think Shawan Hawks have done a great job of controlling the line of scrimmage, dictating the pace of the game, the tempo of the game. And they're showing a lot of different looks, but it's the same run. They might have two people in the backfield, but they're still going to hand off and do a power right, or they might do a little pitch to the outside or some type of counter run. But they do a great job of just mixing the formations, but keeping it basic in terms of what the play actually is, and it's allowing their players to make good plays.
Well, as we switch sides of the field to get ready to start off the second quarter, Shawan with the ball, second and two, ball at the 18. Dixon gets it, and it looks like we may have a penalty in a play, and that's going to be a false start. And that'll take him back 5 yards.
Wonder if that's a illegal formation or a false start. There's so many motions by the Hawks. You are surprised that that's the first false start of the game, because normally when everybody's moving around before the ball is snapped, you get more false start penalties. But break for the Hornets. Now it's second and seven. Hold them, make it third and seven. A longer completion has to be made. So hopefully they can take advantage of that.
Second and seven, ball on the 23. Great point there, Derek. Anything that can help this defense out, I'm sure they will appreciate it as they try to get themselves together here in the second quarter. Just underway here. No time has left the clock yet. Still 15 minutes remaining. Man in motion is going to go to him. Dixon looks left. Actually fakes it. Throws it to number 10. He makes the guy miss, and he is going to run into the end zone. That's going to be another touchdown, ladies and gentlemen. Kane Lombard on a little bit of a double team action. Yes, what is going on there as the Hornets give up an easy play?
They did a great job. Each time they move somebody in motion, the Hornets just key on him, and they forgot on the backside there. And Gamble had to make a very difficult tackle. Unfortunately for him, he couldn't bring the guy down, had to split a blocker. But just a great job once again by the Hawks, moving people in motion, having his defense second-guessing themselves, and they are getting really destroyed on the defensive side of the ball right now.
And I think you talked about that as we get ready for the PAT here. Hula looks to make it 21-0 lead. He does. And just underway in the second quarter, 14-52. That's a great question. Has the quarter even changed? Because it seems like we're still in the first quarter. But the Hornets, once again, it looks like a repeat of last year, giving up easy plays. And the coach's play worked to perfection there.
Exactly. Each time they hit them with the reverse, and then they'll fake the reverse and throw it outside for an easy screen play. And they're really getting killed by that. They have to be disciplined and knowing what's about to happen. And Gamble was forced to make a really tough play. I cannot blame him for not being able to make that tackle. He was 15 yards back and had to sprint all the way up there to make a tackle. It was just a very hard play for him to make. As you see, the crowd at least is still into it. And that's what we hope to see the entire season, is to get the crowd into it, and hopefully that energy can rub off on the players and they can play with more swagger and more passion that we haven't seen so far in this game.
Well, Derek, if the offense ever needed to put a drive together, I think this would be the time. And the Hornets have to find a way to get this crowd involved. A lot of people are sitting on their hands waiting for something to happen. Wonder if they're watching the 2014 Hornets, but it's a different season, different coach. We'll see what happens. A long way to go. And the offense will take the field after this kickoff. Hula will kick off again. He's definitely getting his work out today, but that's a good thing for Shawan, as that means they're putting points on the board for him. Hula with the kick. Low kick. It will bounce. Scott will get it. Waits for it. Gets it. Runs left. Has some space. Tries to make a guy miss, but gets out to the 30. And a nice return there.
If Kyle Taylor could have held that block a little bit longer, Scott might still be running. Good job by Scott handling that kick, because a bouncing kick like that with 11 people flying at you is very dangerous, but he was able to compose himself and make a good play, get them in some good field position, and can they make a play happen here? And also, we're going to get an offsides on a kick by the kicking team, so that'll be enforced. So now the ball is moving up even more for the Hornets. Big possession here.
Every little bit helps, and like you said, the offsides will give the offense 5 more yards. So the Hornets will move to about the 35 with 1st and 10 with 14:45 remaining.
I wonder if that kick was on purpose. It was so short that it was sort of like they were going to try to, like, recover the kick before Scott can get a good, clean handle on it. The Hawks have been playing with a lot of confidence and taking a lot of chances. Luckily, Scott was able to handle that bounce. But actually, I think they're going to re-kick it, which I think is a smart strategy. You have 11 Hawks that just flew down the field. They may be a little tired, and they might not be able to get to Scott this time.
Looks like they're going to re-kick, Derek. So what do you think about that decision there?
Yeah, like I said, they're going to re-kick, and that will allow Scott. Hopefully, the Hawks' kicking team is a little tired. They just ran 60 yards down the field, so you're hoping that Scott can get some room to run because everybody on the other side is exhausted.
I think they know that if Eric Scott had one more block, he had an opportunity to break a big game. So maybe they're thinking that here, and they have faith in him. It'll be interesting to see what happens here. Kahula will kick the ball off here. Ball is kicked. Scott doesn't get it this time, but it's his counterpart, Allen, and he runs out actually further than before and gets to about the 48.
Good job. That's what we've talked about in. Number 3 on the other side of the team, Fulton was trying to force a personal foul on one of the Hornets, just flopped, trying to win an acting Grammy there, Oscar there, but a good job by the refs not calling it. And good field position for the Hornets. Can they do something finally? Can they put a drive together?
Great correction by you. It is an Oscar. But 48-yard line, 1st and 10, Obado. And the Hornets with the ball. And like Derek said, do they have something in them? As they come out a little bit of a pistol formation, try to move this ball. Fake, drops deep, has a man, overthrows Golston by about 10 yards, and that will set up 2nd down.
Really good coverage by the Hawks. They're up 21-0, so they're not really caring about a play action because they want the underneath stuff. They want the runs. They want them to milk the clock. So the play action is not going to throw them off guard, and good coverage down the field for the Hawks.
Excellent coverage, and Obado just overthrew his man and missed it. So not giving the receiver a chance there, and 2nd down. It looks like Obado will be under center. Hands it off left, and that's going to be a gain of about 1 yard. And not much running room there for Kelsey Tyler.
That's what happens when you can get into the backfield. That's what we want to see the Hornets do. No matter what the run is, if you can get 2-3 people in the backfield, then there's nowhere for the running back to go. And Taylor was just met by a whole gang of Hawks for that play.
Obado in the shotgun. 2 receivers to his right. Tyler in the backfield beside him. To his left. Takes the snap. Obado reading through his progression. Steps up. We have a flag, could be coming back for a hold. And Obado not trying to go down. And last time that happened, he did fumble, but there's a flag on the play, and we'll see what happens.
I think it might be on Mangone with the hold, the center. Not 100% sure, but he's the one that looks the most disappointed as he just tackled his man to the ground, so that might be the call.
And that's going to be holding on the offense, and that'll bring him back 10 yards. And set up a 3rd down and 9. So 3rd and long. What does Shawan do here on defense?
Probably just allow an underneath throw and make a short tackle. if I'm the Hornets, I would like to get Obado rolling out and allow him to either run or pass, let him get out on the edge and make the defenders choose which they want to guard. And I think it's 3rd and 19, actually, so might just want to hand this off and run a screen and just get as much yards as you can and try to pin them deep.
So 3rd and 19, excuse me, 13:40 remaining. Second quarter, Obado will come out, empty backfield, four wide receivers, gets the snap. They have to make a play here. Someone goes deep, has Golston. Ball is tipped, and it looks like Hornets will have to punt again. That's number 24, Anthony Prince, on the coverage there, and Hornets will have to punt, Derek.
Prince got away with a hold on that play, kind of grabbed Golston's jersey. Everybody was looking for a flag, but Obado has to get that throw a little further down. He underthrew Golston anyway. That might be the reason why a flag wasn't thrown. Had Golston for a touchdown if he put that out in front of him.
Tough spot for the Hornets here. You don't want to go for it. It'll be too long, but punting it, you know, the Shawan will have a good shot to possibly get it in. Scoring opportunity again past midfield. And McGee, you hopefully won't get his punt blocked. Protection there, good by the special teams unit. And it will take a Hornet bounce. And he tries to pick it up. And that's number 6, Anthony Elliott. Not a wise choice there.
And good job by Skia Bindle to make the play there, chasing him down and making a tackle. That's a play that they need. And hopefully they can get a stop and get some good field position as Elliott's limping a little bit, maybe just a little upset that and embarrassed that he tried to run that one back.
Well, any help the Hornets can use, they definitely need it. And having a good punt there, McGee was a pretty good punter, and it'll give Shawan the ball at the 8-yard line to start their drive as we approach 13 minutes remaining here in the first half. Shawan huddling up, something we haven't seen a lot of today, and they've used a lot of shotgun in motion. Have the Hornets adjusted? That'll be the question on this drive as you see Dixon come out. Dixon gets the snap, hands it off, and that play goes for about a gain of 1. And the Hornets does a good job there as you see the carry by Reggie Williams. And a gain of 1, 2nd and 9.
Good job there not being fooled on a play and making a sure tackle. 2nd and 9 is much better than what they've been giving up. So see if they get another stop or another short gain and force them into 3rd and long.
Shawan in the shotgun, ball at the 9. Dixon, clean pocket to throw from, and that pass is incomplete. Intended for Ryan Nolan on the play.
Kevin McCoy got away with a huge hold. If they called it, it would have been a safety because it was in the end zone. But he had the entire shoulder pad of Gabe Sherrod on that play on the outside. And you can see him adjusting the pad, trying to get his shoulder pad fixed because he got it pulled off of him.
3rd and 9. Hornets might try to bring some pressure here. 12:40 remaining. Dixon takes the snap. Hornets bring pressure. It's going to be a screen, but it's sniffed out by the Hornets. And a great job there by the Hornets defense. Number 88, Gabriel Sherrod. Derek talked about him, a converted tight end. Great job there by the defense.
And you definitely can see that tight end speed as he chased down a running back for that tackle. And he was upset he didn't get that hold because he had a clear shot at Dixon on the play before. So great job. Great two plays by him to force this 3rd and out.
Great point there, seeing what he's able to do, not only being converted from offense to defense, but being effective and stepping right into that starting role after the departures of Gunther on that line. So looks like it'll be the first punt of the day, I believe, for Shawan here. Hahula punts it. Looks like it might have been partially blocked. Scott gets it at the 40, and he'll go down immediately, 39.
It's a flag, so we're probably going to get roughing the kicker. They definitely roughed him up, but normally if you hit the ball, they let it go. Kind of surprised. They hit the ball, so if they call this roughing the kicker, that's 15 yards and a huge, huge problem for the Hornets that they finally was able to force a punt on defense.
Refs will adjudicate and see what the call will be on the play. A And looks like they do get the roughing the kicker call.
So, fortunately for the Hornets, we're going to get a running into the kicker. So, they'll still punt it. And Hahula did a good job of limping around right next to the refs to force that flag there. Normally, the ball gets hit and you don't call that. So, I'm surprised. I don't understand why that call was made at all.
Fortunately, it was the running into and not the roughing. Only the 5-yard variety, not the 15. So, Hornets will have another shot. Maybe they can block this one. Eric Scott back at his 50, at the 50-yard line. Takes a few steps in.
The refs had to call a timeout because the ball should be at the 17-yard line. They still have it at the 12, and that's where the communication is at. So now they're going to move the ball up. 4th and 1, I hope for the Hornets' sake that they punt it because they've struggled getting the Hawks off the field. But you expect the Hawks would punt it in a situation. They're up 21 points. You don't want to give the Hornets prime field position to actually get some points on the board. So, but it'll be interesting to see when you're dealing with a team that's a Division II team that's trying to put their foot on your neck and end you. You never know what to expect.
So we'll get another punt here. Scott will go back deep. Hahula will punt this time with a little bit more room in the shadow of his own end zone. Hornets bring pressure again. This time they almost get to him, but he gets it off cleanly. Scott will not touch it, and it will take a Shawan bounce all the way to the 32-yard line. What about that punt there, Derek?
Scott's looking over to the sideline saying the sun might have gotten his eyes on that one. And even though people were going to sigh and be upset that they didn't get it, if he grabs that ball and gets hit and fumbles, it's much worse than it being on a 32, 33-yard line. So I think you probably want to see Scott catch that ball, but at the same time, he was put in a bad situation on that play.
Yeah, like you said, if he caught it, he might have got rocked and could have fumbled and caused another turnover. As a bottle on the offense comes out. Ball at the 36. 11:54 remaining in the first half. Hornets run a reverse. Golson gets it, has some blocking. Gets a big gain, a gain of about 8.
That's a nice wrinkle there, having Golson in the reverse. When you give the ball to him with space, he's very dangerous, as we saw not last season, but his freshman year when he really showed out for the Hornets. So, got to get him involved. He's their impact player on his team, besides, of course, Obado.
Second and 3, Obado hands it off. Jackson with the shoot move, runs right and gets a first down. Good run there by Jamal Jackson.
And that's a skill of a good running back. Can you make that first person miss? Your line's going to block 10 of them. You have to be able to get that other guy if you want to get positive yards, and a good juke move there.
Hornets picking up the tempo here. No huddle offense. Give it off to Jackson again. Jackson runs left. Has some space. Has a blocker. Runs left and gets a big gain of about 15 yards. And they're looking for a flag, but it won't get it. And 11:29 remaining. And the Hornets have a little bit going here, especially on the ground.
Yeah, good job on the outside. Receivers doing a good job blocking. That's how you always get those good outside runs. And Fletcher took a little cheap shot, but he didn't follow through. And that's why the penalty wasn't called.
Obado now formation. Makes the guy miss. He's going to step up and run. Gets a gain of about 5. Gets down wisely.
I would like to see him put 2 hands on the ball when he runs, especially when you're running through the middle of a defense. But good move to shake away the pressure and get 7 yards.
Great point there. Ball on the 39. 11 minutes remaining in the first half. And the Hornets are moving the ball down the field. Obado hands it off to Jackson. Jackson runs right, makes the guy miss, gets up inside, doesn't go down, but we'll get a gain of about 2 yards. Well, Derek, they're trying to move the ball on the ground, and it's worked a little bit on the drive.
And now you're starting to see the Hornets impose their will. A couple of Hawks are down on a play. And Jackson, he's a tough running back. He might be smaller, be one of the smaller backs that you'll see, but he's shifty and he has a lot of lower leg strength, and he's able to make some people miss and run over a couple people as we have a Hawk running off the sideline.
That's going to be number 91, Wesley Bray, D lineman. And Hornets will have the ball once again at the 34-yard line. I formation. Big set in. Hornets could be trying to run the ball again, establish the tempo here. They do. Jackson gets it left, spins back, but nowhere to go, nowhere to hide. He loses a yard, and Shawan defense was all over that.
And I like that they're running the ball, but I would hope that later on in the season, Carter gives Obito the ability to check to a pass, to be able to kill whatever the run play is and whatever the pass option is, go to that, because they had 8-9 people in a box, and there was no way for Jackson to get any positive yards on that one.
That is the question. Will Coach Carter put the faith in his quarterback to make the reads at the line? Obito in the I formation. 9:40 remaining. Fourth and six, and they're going for it. Pass over the top. Has a man. It is knocked away. Tried to find Ortiz. And that is going to be knocked away. Pass defended by number 21, Kenny Watt. And that last name, Watt, you got to be able to play some defense.
Exactly. And good job by Watt getting his head turned around at the last second to make a play. And Ortiz, he needs to disguise it a little bit, not to let the defender know that the ball is on the way. Don't put your hands up until that ball is almost there so the corner can't look at your eyes and determine, okay, the ball is in the air, let me turn around and make a play. Because clearly you can see Ortiz looking and waiting, and that forced Watt to turn around and make a great deflection at the last second.
And now Shawan has the ball again. And they look to add more points on the board. Ball at the 35. Dixon in the shotgun. Ball is handed off, and it is stuffed. After a gain of about 2 yards of what the defense is looking like, they're trying to get up and play, Derek.
And Malik Harris, who looked like he was on a tackle, and he's ninth in the MEAC in tackles. I mean, ninth in the country in tackles, I'm sorry. And good to see him starting to flash on the field. Good run stop there.
Great point there. You're ninth in the country. You're doing something right. A lot of great defensive players in college football. Dixon takes it, gives it off. Run is taken in by number 29, Reginald Williams. He bumbles ahead for about 4 yards. Sets up about a third and five.
And that play on there was a mistake by Sherrod. He was too wide. He's going after the quarterback. This is a team that's up 21 that's looking to run. So he has to be aware of what he's doing. He has to be aware of, okay, I have to run blitz or run stop. I cannot just leave a gap where my position was at. I can't do that.
Third and four, 8:30. Ball on the 42-yard line. Can the Hornets get a stop here? Hornets bring some pressure. Picked up by the line of Shawan, and it is wide open, but he drops it. Heard those footsteps coming. Number 84, Torrey Baker with the drop.
Even though it's a drop, you're wondering who was guarding him because he was wide open, but fortunately they were able to make the stop. Fourth and four. Once again, the Hornets will get the ball. They showed some life in the last possession, but they have to get something on the board.
As you said, Derek, we're approaching 8 minutes in the second half. Plenty of time for the Hornets to – first half, excuse me – to get something going. And it starts with the balance, as you talked about in your keys to the game. And maybe the defense can make a play that they did in the past two games and create something for this offense, which has seemed to be the scapegoat of this team. Haula with the punt. Spirals it towards the sideline, and Scott will take it at his own 11. And the Hornets will have a long way to go, Derek, to put some points on the board.
Another possession here that they have to get something going. It feels like we've been saying that for the last four or five, but when will they get points on the board? You got to get your fans something to enjoy, especially in the first half. You don't want them to walk out on you in the second half. So this is a crowd that desperately wants this team to recreate some success that they had a couple seasons ago when they were 6-5 and were in a race to win the MEAC Conference Championship. So can they get back to that? They've lost a few people, of course. Milton Williams isn't the deep threat that he's gone now, so he's not the deep threat. And Malik Golson has to fill his shoes. But they have to find somebody to make a play. Who's that go-to guy on this offense that can get something going? It looked like Jackson for a moment. So maybe if you're not running the ball, maybe get it to him out on a flat.
Hornets come out, ball at the 11, and we're going to have a timeout, I believe, by the Hornets, as they didn't see something they like Coach Carter. Well, Derek, what do you think about that?
It was about to be a delay of game, so they had to burn another timeout. But how do you have a delay of game on a change of possession like that? Normally, you have that first play called already. A little miscommunication once again, and it's been a little miscommunication, but it's been hurting them a lot because it's happening every play, and they have to clean this up. I know it's the third game, the first home game of the season, but they're going to have to clean this up in practice sooner or later because you can't be in a MEAC conference doing something like that, playing against Bethune-Cookman of teams coming up soon.
Great point there, Derek. This is only a Division II team, not taken away from Shawan, but like you said, this is a game they should have an advantage in and have the ability to win, especially at home. And then looking at that, the rest of their games are going to be tough MEAC opponents as we head to the end of the season. Well, the Hornets will try it one more time, Derek. And we'll see what Obado and that offense can do. As they have the ball at the 11, as we're at 8:10 remaining in the second half. Shawan leads 21-0. Scott gets it on a quick throw. Gets a gain of about 2 yards, and a quick decision there by Obado. Get the ball up quick.
Exactly. Get some positive yards. They've been in some long third downs this game, and you don't want that to happen. In order to sustain possessions, you got to get those 3, 4, 5 yard gains to keep the ball moving.
Hornets come out again, pistol. Ball is given to Jackson, and he spins the head, gets a gain of about 2 yards, and that's set up about a third and three, as we're under 8 minutes remaining here in the second half.
Jackson loves to do that spin move, but he scares me a little bit when he does that in the middle of traffic like that. Somehow he never fumbles, but taking a lot of shots when he does that.
Great point. Third and manageable. Third and two, Obado. Three receivers to his right, none to his left. Takes it. Jackson with the block. Has a man. It is knocked away as it got his hands on it. That's going to be number 25, Najee Jackson, saying his first action of the day, but couldn't quite get it just out of the reach. And is that going to be another three and out for the Hornets? I believe so.
That was a situation where they brought pressure, and Obado had to rush that throw and had Jackson open, but not really open. If he caught it, he probably would have still been brought down shy of the first down. So unfortunate possession there. They have to get. They cannot continue to have these three and outs. They're putting their defense in a bad situation. This is their third, might be their fourth three and out of the first half.
Not many first downs to think of. And that is a ugly punt there by McGayu. And we don't often say that, but it's going to take a bounce and go out of bounds at about the 28, where you'll see Shawan with another shot opportunity to move the ball here. And the Hornets actually only have about 2 first downs, I believe.
Yeah, they've definitely struggled moving the ball down the field. And this is a defense that normally can make a play. Colson has 4 touchdowns in his career. William Burton had a fumble recovery for a touchdown last game. They scored 14 points off their defense last game against Kent State. They might have to do something like that again to come back.
As we get a good shot there of the newly installed Jumbotron, as Dixon comes out with 4 wide receivers. Ball at the 28-yard line. 7:15 remaining. Dixon takes the snap. Steps up in the pocket. Goes to the flat. And we got a flag on the play there. As always for the call, but that pass was to number 11, Marcus Hampton.
Nick Nelson got held on that play. He had a good shot at the quarterback, so the line did what they were supposed to do and keep your quarterback protected, and he held on that play. So this one will be coming back.
So a good another play for the Hornet defense. And the last few drives, they've been holding their own. And Shawan moves back until the 20-yard line. Great job by the Hornet defense.
I know we were talking badly about the defensive line in the first quarter, but the second quarter, they've definitely made some plays and forced some penalties because of that.
Well, Dixon will try it again. 3 wide receivers in a bunch to his left. New formation there. fumbles it but gets it back, and that's going to be given, as you see a lot of good moves there by number 11, Marcus Hampton, a gain of about 6. And that'll set up second down and 10. So a gain of 10, excuse me, and 6:35 remaining.
Good run inside there, and they have to be able to wrap up and make some tackles. These one-hand arm tackles do not bring running backs down too often. They have to do a better job of wrapping up.
Dixon picking up the tempo. Has a shotgun. Offensive line picks it up. He's taking a shot deep. Has a man one-on-one. It is up. Knocked away and almost intercepted. No flag on the play, and the Hornets do a good job there of straight man-to-man coverage and great help by the safety.
Good job by Mark Flakes getting his head around at the last second. If he did not, they probably would have thrown that flag. But he turned around, got a hand up. Contact was going both ways, so they just allowed those two guys to play, and Flakes made the better play on that play.
6:15 remaining, 3rd and 10. The Hornets can use a stop here with the opportunity to get the ball back and make one more drive before halftime. Looks like Dixon will come out in an empty set. Shotgun, 5 receivers, 3 to his left, 2 to his right. Watch out for Gabriel Sherrod off the side, trying to bring pressure. Pass is incomplete, and the Hornets do a great job holding their own, and they'll get the ball back with 6:10 remaining.
They brought Barrett, their defensive back, on a corner blitz, and it forced the ball to be thrown too quickly for the incompletion. Good job, good call, a good aggressive call by the Hornets to force another 3-and-out.
Hornets will have another opportunity. Erskine back deep to return. Hornets could use a big play by either the defense or the special teams to put a bolt in their offense and get something going here as they're down 21-0 on their home field. Punt is low, and it's going to take a Hornet bounce and go inside at the 44-yard line, and the Hornets will set up shop.
It took a weird bounce. I thought it might have hit a Hornet on that play, but the ref said it did not. And that's a fortunate break, because if it did, that counts as a fumble, and that would have been a Hawks ball. They've done some weird punts that the Hornets have had some trouble fielding so far.
6 minutes remaining. Hornets, another chance to try to put some type of points on the board here. 21-0 is the score. Obadu. With Dayon Chong to his right. Chong getting some action. He'll get the carry. Runs left. Nowhere to go there. Gets a gain of about 1 as he moves out to about the 45-yard line. So no running room there. And I think Shawan knows they're trying to run the ball.
Exactly. They know that they're trying to get some positive yards to make these completions a little easier. But I don't know why Obado would do the handoff, well, fake the handoff, and then run the exact same play, exact same way as the running back. And really was no room to go.
Hornets with the ball, 2nd and 8, 5:30 remaining. Shawan looking to bring pressure. They do. Obado throws it, incomplete. A little bit of a bad throw there, a little bit too low for his receiver. And the Hornets will face a 3rd and 8. And Derek, they're in a 3rd and long situation. What do they do here?
Good job by the Hawks once again, just bringing some pressure and forcing these rush throws. Obado has to be more accurate, though. It cannot have these incompletions. They just kill drives.
You're definitely right about that, Derek. And we have an opportunity here to try to keep this drive going, but the Hornets haven't been able to convert on 3rd down, and that was one of your keys to the game, and it's coming to fruition here. Shawan only had 10 players on the field. They get 11. Fake, and it looks like Obado will make a guy miss. He's going to take a shot. Has a man, and that's going to be overthrown. And he had Golston wide open. Almost a big play opportunity for the Hornets, and just on the outside part of Golston.
Great effort, though, by Obado. He almost had a big play, got drilled at the end of it, and this is a guy coming off of a lower back injury that he missed the entire last season with, out there making people miss and still trying to make plays happen. I love the effort. I love it.
That was a great play. You really can't fault him for that. He definitely tried to make something happen, and I think the Hornets definitely should try to take more shots down the field as we get into the second half, and McGayu will be out for another punt. And Hornets with the adjustment of the line and do anything to protect their punter and protect the punt from being blocked as well. McGayu gets it. He's going to keep it. And it's going nowhere. And it looks like it might be a flag. And I don't know what to say about that one, Derek. That was a call I didn't see coming. And Magayu tried to run with it, but there was nowhere to go.
That's a horrible play. I don't understand why you want your punter to try to run 8 yards for a first down. That's something you do maybe fourth and one, fourth and two. But fourth and eight, you want your punter to go run? You might as well just put the offense out there and take a shot. People would appreciate that more than a fake punt.
Very seldom seeing the punter run. You see the punter throw mainly. But I guess that was just something they wanted to try. And McGee's not the most athletic player, so kind of makes you scratch your head.
Exactly, and everything was covered downfield because they had the gunners out there. So, of course, the Hawks were going to follow just in case it was a fake, and it was finally a fake, and it fooled nobody.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Delaware State fans, the Hornets defense is on the field yet again, and fatigue has to be a factor on a hot day like this, Derek.
It definitely is a factor. All these three and outs, too, does not help them getting any rest. So, once again, somebody has to make a play. Can it be Malik Harris or Sherrod or Colson? They need to get a turnover here. They got to get something to bring momentum to the Hornets' side. But we continue to say it, but nothing seems to be happening, at least in the first half.
Fortunate part is they still have 35 minutes to make something happen. 35 minutes and 10 seconds to be exact. And we'll see what they come up with, as Coach Carter will definitely have to make halftime adjustments. It's first and 10 on a 39 for Shawan, as they look to try to put this game in a big spot, try to go up maybe possibly 28 points on a Hornet offense that can't even get the ball into the red zone. Shawan comes out in a pistol formation, something we see a lot of nowadays in a lot of offenses. Fake throw is there, and it is intercepted. And that's going to be number 19, J.R. Robinson. He has a shot to score. He will roll out the red carpet. He has reservations for six. And the Hornets finally get on the board. And the crowd comes alive, Derek. And right on cue, the Hornet defense gets it done.
That's something we were hoping for. Make some play happen. And fortunately, J.R. Robinson was Johnny on the spot, picked it off, and took it to the house himself.
Well, Derek, it looks like he was in the right place at the right time. Active hands, jazzy hands, if you want to use a basketball term, and he made it happen. And once he caught it, no one was going to catch him. And I think everybody in the building knew he had a reservation for six.
Exactly. Just good job there. Concentrating. Normally, tip balls are hard to catch for anybody, but he did a good job concentrating, getting two hands on it, and making sure he caught it before he worried about finishing and taking it to the house.
Hornets are going to go for two here. No, they're not going to go for two. Obato is the holder. And Wisdom Nisdy is going to be the kicker. And looks to try to cut this lead to 14 points. Kick is up. Kick is good. And the kick is good. 21-7 is the score, Derek. 4:56 remaining. Well, Derek, that's something that can change momentum quickly.
Exactly. And you can just see the spirits lift. Just amazingly. Everybody's heads are up now when they're saying, hey, we can come back. We can still win this game. There's still a lot of time remaining. That's what happens when a defense can go and make a play of their own. And now the crowd's up and moving. People are dancing. And you got people standing up and music is playing. And people want to see the Hornets succeed. So hopefully this is what they needed to do to make that happen.
Anything will help. And as we've seen time and time again, this defense makes a play. They had their backs against the wall a lot today. But last few drives, Shawan hasn't been able to move the ball as effectively. And the defense comes up right on time and definitely makes a great play there. And look at that. Just then, DSU's last three touchdowns have been scored by the defense. And they had two last week against Kent State. Talk a little bit about that, Derek.
It's not really the best stat, honestly, if you want to be the pessimist. But if you want to be an optimist, you're saying, hey, we got a really good defense. Maybe we should start some of them on offense or hopefully just have something happen like that more often. But the offense needs to pick up their side. They're in it and make some plays happen. Because the defense can't be your leaders in scoring.
A lot of the 2000 Ravens, where the offense didn't score for, what, a whole half a season pretty much. And as you see, the Hornets have some momentum. Crowd is alive, as Derek stated. Hopefully this is something they can take advantage of and maybe could even have a shot of getting the ball back with a little under 2 minutes remaining if they can get a three and out here. And that kick is going to be a touchback. So the Hornet defense is out again. And we got a little testiness right here between Shawan and DSU. And it's going to be an intense second half.
Rogers was barking a little bit at the Hawks on that last play. But good kick, forcing the touchback. And as bad as the defense looked in the first quarter, they really turned around in the second quarter, forcing some three and outs. And, of course, that pick six that just happened. And the crowd is into it. Can the defense make another step, or can they score another touchdown? They've done that a lot lately in the last two games.
It'll be interesting to see how Dixon overcomes adversity and how this offense does. It seems like the Hornets have keyed in on those short, quick passes and that motion. And they've made great adjustments even before the second half. Dixon stays in the shotgun, has some more motion. Guy runs behind him. And it's going to go to the right, and that's going to be Reginald Williams on the carry, a gain of about three.
Good job that time by the corners, helping out and keeping them from these outside runs that were hurting them so much in the first quarter to contain it to 4 or 5 yards. Still good yardage for the Hawks, but not as good as it was in the first quarter when they were making those runs turn into 17-yard games.
Second down and four. Ball on the 31. 4:25 remaining. Dixon and shotgun. Hands it off again. Williams has a parting like the Red Sea the Hornets did there. And he's carrying defenders with him in a big gain in the first down for Shawan.
The defensive line continues to key on getting sacks against Dixon. He's just handing the ball off. Once again, the defensive line is they're behind the line of scrimmage. They have a chance to make a play, but they choose wrong and forces another difficult situation for the Hornets. It's his first and 10 on their 47.
Definitely, as a defense, you don't want to overcommit and get too excited off of the score. And that's a lot of times how defenses get burned on the back end. And it looks like Shawan will have three wide receivers to the right. Dixon in the shotgun, one to his left. Hornets corners are playing a little bit off. Anthony Prince in motion. Williams gets it again, has some more room. Makes another guy miss and gets out across the 45-yard line into the 42 in a big gain in the first down.
And once again, Sherrod went too far up the field, leaving a gaping hole on the right side. That's the second time he's done that this quarter. He has to be more disciplined in knowing they're running the ball. I cannot go right at the quarterback. I have to – my responsibility is to tackle the running back first.
Dixon and Shawan, offense gives it to Williams again, and the defense knows it's going to him, and they get him and bring him down once again.
And once again, they're just trying to run the rest of this clock out and hopefully get a point if you're a Hawks fan and make it 28-7 or 24-7 with no time left in the first half.
Shawan up two touchdowns. We approach 3 minutes remaining, second and eight. And the Hornets do maybe have an opportunity to get the ball back with time on the clock. Dixon, two receivers to his left, two to his right. Gets the snap. Looks like it'll be a hold, and this play will come back. It'll go to number 18, Damian Ellis, but that play will come back, and that'll be a hold.
Tizzer once again getting pressure and forcing a hold. That will make it second and 18, and a flag is out. Tarek Olsen was on the tackle, but that won't matter. It'll be second and 18. And another holding play, another chance for the Hornets to force a punt. It's second and 18, make it third and 15 or third and 14, and make something happen.
Great job. It's like the defensive line of the Hornets has answered your call, Derek, and they're starting to impose their will on this offensive line of Shawan. And the only thing they can do to stop him is hold him.
Exactly. This is a line that can be dominant with Tizard on one side and Sherrod on the other. They're doing a good job. And, of course, we haven't even talked about Harris as a great linebacker he is. They're able to get pressure and force these linemen to hold and put their offense in bad situations.
So it's going to be second down and 18. Ball on the 50 at midfield. 2:48 remaining. Shawan in an empty set. Dixon alone in a shotgun. Hornets are trying to bring pressure. They do. And that's going to be a clean shot and another interception. Great play there by the Hornets, bringing the pressure. He's coming back the other way. That's number 42, Malik Harris. He has a brigade of blockers. He gets inside to the 10-yard line. What a play there, Derek, and pressure creates that. Number 17, Rashawn Barrett on a hit.
And I just said we weren't talking about the great linebacker Malik Harris, and he picks the ball off and takes it almost to the house. Defense, they're starting to get the crowd into it. They're making the plays that we expected them to make when the game started. And I don't understand why the Hawks went into an empty set, because the offensive line's having such a tough time controlling these linemen. And then they sent the blitz, a delayed corner blitz by Barrett. That's the second time they did it, the second time they had success with that pressure. Great job by everybody on that play to make something happen.
Great job there by the Hornets, and it looks like they are they going to go for two here. Oh, they didn't score. Excuse me. I'm sorry. Ball's at the 10, and that's going to go inside, and the Hornets are going to try to make play here. 2:15. I got so excited myself. I thought he scored, but we see a lot of testiness on the offense, and the Hornets are changing momentum here.
A touchdown here would be huge to such a bad first half to only be down 7. They have to get something into the end zone here. This is huge for Carter to get something going for this team to build momentum.
Obadu with the ball at the 8. 8 yards to pay dirt. Gets it 3 to his right, and that'll be a false start. And there go the yellow flags again. The yellow launch is on the field, and Hornets can't afford that.
They were sending some pressure and just scared the offensive line. They had a cornerback coming off the edge, number 8, Stafford, and it forced the Hornets. They panicked, and they jumped offsides. Offsides for the false start. So 2nd and 13, and that's huge there. It's hard to score the end zone as it is, and when you're in the red zone because it's so compact. Now you're down in terms of down in distance. They have to make a play, and they're going to burn a timeout here to figure out what to do.
Shawan will call a timeout. Well, Derek, as we have a break in the action, thinking about that fumble early on in the game, how that shift the momentum? How about these last 2 interceptions? What have they done for this team?
Well, I don't want to go back into the fumble. Of course, you just want to protect the ball. But in terms of the interceptions, it's brought this place alive again. Once again, they have a chance to make something happen. And as you see, Tim Place is talking to his players saying, hold them to a field goal. That's how we win, is to hold them to a field goal. So hopefully for the Hornets and Coach Carter, they can draw up a play to get something in the end zone. I don't know what it is, but make something happen here.
Well, 2nd and 13, 1:49 remaining. Hornets have a shot here to put some points on the board as they try to get back early on in this game. Obadu and a shotgun. 4 wide receivers. Has Eric Scott one-on-one. He's going to throw it up. It's knocked away. Great defense there on the island. And that's going to be Terrell Saffold with a great defensive cover.
Good coverage there. And good job pinning him towards the sideline, not giving him a lot of space for that fade route. But Obadu has to throw that a little higher. Scott, of course, has the advantage in terms of height. He has to throw that a little higher and give Scott a chance to make a play on the football.
Let's see what the Hornets do here on 3rd and 13. Trying to get in the end zone. Cut this lead to 7. 4 wide receiver set. Obadu throws it to the middle of the field. Has a man. It is caught. And I believe that's Malik Ghostin. Hornets with the reservations for 6. What a play there and what a throw.
Great job. But for some reason, the Hawks, they were standing in the end zone. So good job by Malik Ghostin just slanting in front of that safety and making the catch. He's a terrific slot receiver for the Hornets. And had a down season sophomore year, but now with Obadu throwing the ball, expect him to have a lot of big numbers again like he had his freshman year.
Talk about Obadu. What a play there. And what a throw. Taking advantage of the soft spot in the defense. And Hornets have a chance to cut this lead to 7 with 1:36 remaining. And you talk about a tie changing in an instant. Nothing like this, and we've seen it in this game. And we could be in for an exciting finish. As Wisdom looks to make the extra point to cut it to 7. It's up and good.
And just to go back on that throw, great job, great ball placement to put it low so Ghostin doesn't get hit and drop the ball. Good job putting it low, let him dive forward and make the catch and protect your receiver when he's running those inside routes. And 21-14, who knew the score would end up looking like this after that poor first quarter, but the defense answered the call with 2 straight interceptions.
Well, Derek, the offense is waking up. The defense is playing like the defense. And this team definitely shows a lot of potential when they're clicking on all cylinders. And Coach Carter has to get credit for turning his team around just like that. It seems like he said the right things to them in those timeouts and those huddles.
Exactly. And it's starting because they're finally stopping to run a little bit. And also the penalties by the Hawks are putting them in passing situations. And that's a good pass defense. The Hornets normally have great corners, great safeties that can make a play on the football. Colston is one, Robinson, Burton. The linebackers are good with Harris leading the way, and they get pressure on edges. So whenever you start to pass, that's the defense. That's the strength of the defense for the Hornets, is guarding the ball in the air. As you can see, two straight interceptions.
Hornets will kick the ball off. 1:36 remaining in this exciting, fun-filled first half here. And the Hornet crowd is alive and well, ladies and gentlemen, if you had a question. Looks like the ball can't stay on the tee here. Well, Derek is waiting for the kick. What do you think is going to happen in the last minute and 30?
They have to make sure that they don't allow the Hawks to put any points on this board. So they have to be disciplined. I know they've made a lot of great plays, but you just want to make the sure tackle here. You don't want to play too aggressively going for the ball and giving up a huge play. So just be conservative a little bit and force them to punt or let time run out.
Mays' kick is deep into the end zone. What a kick there. Drives it back, and it'll be a touchback. So special teams, looks like with the departure, they have a new kicker, and he's doing pretty well.
Exactly, and that was a point of emphasis, was to improve the special teams, and we've seen that. Scott has had a couple good returns. They've done a good job of doing the basics well, not fumbling anything, not getting any kicks blocked, which sounds like something small, but it's something that hurt the Hornets in the last two seasons. It's good to see them clean that up.
Definitely under a new regime, new head coach, new coaching staff, new players being bought in. Definitely don't want to see the last things you saw last year when it wasn't a memorable season. So the Hornets here with 1:36 remaining, ball on the 25. Dixon and his crew will come back out in the shotgun, and we'll see what happens here. Will it be conservative or will it be aggressive? Time will tell. Dixon keeps it himself, runs right, has some space, and gets a first down gain of about 12.
I don't know why I keep harping on Sherrod. I don't know if it's part of the formation, but he's really wide, and they're running right through that gaping hole when he goes and after the quarterback. So they have to get him on the line regularly to force them to have to bounce these runs to the outside where the corners and the linebackers can make some more plays.
Seems to be in a wide nine, and everyone else is in a normal technique, but looks like Dixon and his offense is taking note of that and moving the ball. Ball on the 38, first and 10. Pressure by the Hornets. Ball is thrown, and it is incomplete. Intended for number 8, Terrell Saffold.
And a good job getting pressure, and everything was covered on the back end. Coming into this game, this was a pass-happy Hawks, and they shocked the Hornets early with the option run. But now in these situations where they have to pass, which is the strength of the Hornets, you're starting to see that maybe that 70% that Dixon was throwing, maybe it was against lower competition, because the Hornets, they're very good against the pass, and you have to be very accurate to get something off against them.
Dixon, second down. Run is given to number 11. That's Marcus Hampton. Bowls ahead for about 3-yard gain as we are at 1 minute remaining. 21-14, Shawan up by 7, but the Hornets are storming back.
Good job by Abdul Rahman just holding on and making a tackle, not allowing that to be a big gain. The Hornets are going to call a timeout and try to get this ball back for one last chance. 3rd and 5, it's huge though. You call a timeout here and they convert, and they're on your side of the 50-yard line, then the Hawks have become a little bit more aggressive. So this is huge.
Well, Hornets have no more timeouts remaining. What do you think about this offense that you've seen show a lot more consistency in this end of this first half?
I think the defense just done a great job of, in those passing situations, early on they were not knowing what they were supposed to be. Everybody was pointing around trying to figure out, are we in man, are we in zone? They simplified it on the back end and allowing these guys to just react to the football. And they've made a lot of plays. And they've put the Hawks in a situation where now they can't just run out the clock the next half. They have to be aggressive, and they have to throw the ball a little bit more. And that fits right to what the Hornets want them to do.
Dixon in the shotgun. Ball is handed off to number 11 again. That's going to be Marcus Hampton. And looks like Shawan is trying to run out the clock. And the Hornets don't have any more timeouts, so we're at 40 seconds remaining.
and it won't show up on a stat sheet. Malik Harris did a great job. He filled the hole that Sherrod leaves in that wide nine on a middle linebacker blitz, and it forced that run back up into the middle, back up into the defensive tackles for them to make an easy play. Fourth down and three. The time's just going to run down, and it's going to be the end of the half. But great second quarter. Everything was looking bleak, but this defense just came alive and had everybody up off their feet and made this an interesting game again.
Definitely has. It looked like a lot of shades of last year. But I think we see the difference with Coach Carter. Ability to make those quick adjustments, being at some bigger programs and playing with a lot of good caliber talent. What he's able to do with this team, it's early in the season. He's still molding and shaping his guys, but it'll be great to see how this team finish off.
A timeout was called, so it's not going to be the end of the half here. They're still going to run one last play. I'm guessing they're going to have to punt it, or maybe they'll just run the clock out, make sure the Hornets don't touch the football, as we're going to have 2 seconds remaining on the clock.
Trying to figure out the call here. Looks like it was a hold, but I didn't see holding here.
I actually think it's going to be a delay of game because it was a couple seconds left. So 1 second left, they'll probably just hold the ball for a little bit and then take a kneel. Actually, it's going to be 3 seconds on the clock. So let's see what happens here. I think just going to hold the ball, throw it out into the stands or something, take some time off the clock that way.
They are in the victory formation. 3 seconds left, so looks like we're going to go into halftime as the ball is fumbled. And that's going to be the end of the first half, 21-14 to score.
I don't know if that play took 3 seconds. I thought that was probably two. Everybody was looking, is it 1 second left? Can we get a chance? But that's going to be the end of the first half. Nice comeback by the Hornets. Love to see that pride that we speak of show up and make something happen. It's now the Hall of Famers are going to be heading on to the field.
Great point there. I mean, great end to the first half by the Hornets. The momentum has definitely shifted back over to them, and it has been a great sight to see. The offense has come alive, and you see Obado with his abilities inside the pocket making great throws. And Malik Golson, you asked him to show up, and he definitely showed flashes of that freshman season. So, Derek, as we hit it in the halftime, what would you like to see?
We'd like to see the Hornets first handle the running game, stop the running game, stop the option, force them those long third sixes, third to sevens, where they can make a play on the football. But honestly, I got to tip my hat to Tim Place and the Hawks offense for switching things up. This is a team that threw for 375 yards in the first two games. They weren't really running the ball very well. But in the first quarter, they mixed it up, caught the Hornets off guard. But Coach Carter, like a good coach does, made the adjustments, stopped the runs, forced them to finally put the ball in the air, and the Hornets made those plays.
Well, as we have Hall of Fame Day here at Alumni Stadium, you see some of the people being honored. But just some quick facts about the MEAC. Let's look at the games of the day. You have Florida A&M and South Carolina State, Howard versus Hampton, Savannah State at Akron, Shawan at DSU, the game you're watching now, Norfolk State at Marshall, Lane at Bethune-Cookman, Virginia Lynchburg at Morgan State, North Carolina A&T at Elon, and North Carolina Central at Florida International. Now, looking at some tidbits, Bethune-Cookman marked the only MEAC victory in week two. A high-scoring game over Grambling State, 56-53. And the teams lined up against opponents. Two others faced FCS teams. Big shout-out to Tarek Colston. He was named Defensive Player of the Week in the MEAC last week for his interception return for a touchdown last week. The Hornets will look in the second half to tie this game up, as Shawan will receive the second half kickoff. But it will be interesting to see what Coach Carter does, and definitely innovates here with Coach Carter making the adjustments, and they'll see what this defense can continue to do to try to create some turnovers. Stay tuned. We do have coverage of the halftime festivities. We will be back in about 20 minutes with your second half coverage. For Derek Slayton, I'm Byron Dixon. Stay tuned to WDSU TV. We'll be right back.
place kicker was a 2007 Sheridan Broadcast Network Black College All-America and All-NBAC First Team selection. The Hornets career leader with 43 career field goals over the top single season field goal mark in career and season. Also school record holder with 4 field goals in the game. Helped lead the Hornets to the 2007 MEAC Championship and NCAA Tournament appearance. Do your love for 2015 Hall of Famer Peter Gardner. This Hall of Famer is the only player in DSU women's basketball history with more than 1,000 points and 1,000 rebounds. She is the Lady Hornets career leader with 1,091 rebounds and is fifth in team history with 1,515 points. Two-time All-MEAC first team selection. Make some noise for 2015 Hall of Famer Karen Johnson Rogers. This Hall of Famer competed in baseball for Hornets from 1970 to 74. He was fifth in NCAA Division II history in single-season steals per game at 1.95 per game in 1973. He is the Hornets' career leader with 77 stolen bases. Also solid for the Tigers organization. Make some noise for 2015 Hall of Famer Calvin Jones. This Hall of Fame couple has dedicated more than 3 decades of support and donations to the university and its athletic department. Charter members of the Athletic Booster Club helped establish and contributed $50,000 to the Booster Club endowed scholarship for DSU athletics. Also established personal endowed scholarship under DSU Foundation to benefit athletic scholars. Show your love for our Hornet sweetheart couple, James Frank and Mary Jane Marshall. This Hall of Famer is the Hornets career leader with 31 sacks. He was the 1987 MEAC Defensive Player of the Year and two-time All-MEAC First Team selection and a member of the Hornets 1985 championship team. Make some noise for Hall of Famer Robert Chris Perry. This Hall of Famer was a key member of the 1970 Hornet defense that topped all NCAA Division II teams in total defense and rushing defense, each a team record. He was the team leader in sacks during that season. Show your love for 2015 Hall of Famer Willie B. Moore. Also unable to attend this evening, we recognize Hall of Famer Jordan Brown, a legend in Negro League play in the late 1940s and early 50s. Also, two legendary teams were recognized last evening in the Hall of Fame, the 1970 football team, which has led all NCAA Division II teams in rushing defense at minus 4.9 yards per game, and total defense at just 103.5 yards per game, outscored opponents that year, 172-83. Joe Love with the 1970 DSU Hornets football team. And finally, we will recognize the 1985 DSU Hornets MEAC Championship football team, the first MEAC football champion in school history, posted a 9-2 overall record and 5-2 mark in the MEAC. Outscored opponents 387-181. Show some love for your 1985 MEAC Championship football team. Now, will all members of the DSU Athletics Hall of Fame please stand at this time and take a bow as we recognize the DSU Athletics Hall of Fame. So a special hand to our Hall of Fame committee chair, Barry Hill, who joins our president and director of athletics on the field. Once again, make some noise for your Hall of Famers, DSU.
Check one, check two. Your drum major for the 2015 football season is Miss Laquita Whirlwind Williams. Whirlwind, please turn on the sound and let the storm rain down.
Yeah, he just took it down.
Mr. Randolph J. Johnson, and Mr. Lenny Lake. It's that band sensation from the Hornet Nation, the DSU Approving Soul Marching Band. On behalf of President Dr. Harry L. Williams, the DSU Marching Band would like to thank the alumni, students, faculty, staff, and administration for your continuous support of the Approaching Storm Marching Band. Today shows a tribute to the hot hits of the summer with songs from Bruno Mars, Fifth Harmony, Jason Derulo, Tony Tone, Nicki Minaj, and Janelle Monáe. Born as Peter G. Hernandez, Mr. Bruno Mars has become pop music's premier singer and songwriter. Along with Mark Ronson, they were able to create this summer smash. Walking as a diamond drill and performed on the field to this summer's hit of Town Funk. Diamond before your very eyes.
Will all donors who have established these generous accounts please stand? Let's give a DSU Thorough praise for these donors. Hornets, please stand up and show some love to our donors who keep our students moving forward in their pursuit of their goals. Thank you, donors. Together, we are greater than one. Today we are celebrating those who donate to DSU. It's all about the students. Your gifts count greatly in our Greater Than One campaign for students. You can be the difference in a student's life. Make a contribution to the Greater Than One campaign for students. Please take out your phone
and go to DSU.com/greater-than-one and make your donation to the DSU Foundation. Every gift counts toward the campaign and student success. Once again, please mark your calendar for the 2015 President's Scholarship Ball, Saturday, December 12th, at Dover Downs Hotel and Casino. Please register online at desu.edu/DSU. Net proceeds benefit scholarships for students, DSU students.
Welcome back here to the second half of action between the Hawks of Shawin University and your Delaware State University Hornets. What a first half it was here. Once again, joined alongside Derek Slayton. My name is Byron Dixon. We're going to get right into the second half stats. First half stats, excuse me. Derek, talk a little bit about the first half stats and what stood out to you as we get them right on the screen here.
I think the Hawks really caught everybody off guard as a team that normally passes the ball. They came out and ran the ball down the Hornets' throats, and as you can see, 148 yards on the ground. That's something that you would be happy to get for a whole game. But I think the Hornets made that adjustment in the second quarter, started figuring out we have to stop the run first, which was huge for them because then it forced them to throw the ball, and that led to the two turnovers that you see at the bottom of your screen. I think also you got to look at the first downs by the Hornets. Only having four first downs is not what you want to have. That does not build momentum. That's not how you are able to score points. They have to do a better job getting those 10 yards and not looking, you know, for the biggest play, but just to get the ball moving more on the offensive side. But defensively, they did a great job bringing their team back and shutting down that running game and forcing the Hawks to have to be more pass-oriented.
Thank you, Derek, as Shawan will receive the second half kickoff. And we're ready for second half action, ladies and gentlemen. Sit back, relax. And as you see the ball come off the tee, a little bit of wind here. Interesting to see what Coach Carter's second half adjustments will be based on his strong first half finish by his team. Has to see some encouraging signs from what they did. Wisdom ready to kick it off. Kick is deep into the end zone. And it'll be a touchback. A great kick there. And now Shawan will start from the 20-yard line. Well, Derek, what does the defense have to do here? They've done a lot already.
I think what we've seen in the second quarter, they've cleaned up that communication issue. So they can stop the run and still have their corners in a position to make plays on the ball when it's in the air. So, but basically, they have to stop the run again on a first down, force them into second and long, third and long situations where their defensive linemen can be aggressive and get pressure on a quarterback, force holds or get sacks or force a bad throw, which they've done, and which led to a couple interceptions. So continue that game plan, key on the running game, key on the option, make sure you're disciplined and set the edge so they can't get to the outside.
Dixon shotgun, hands it off, and this second half will start a little different than the first half. Dixon and the offense starting by running the ball in a gain of about one. Now to set up a second and 9, I believe, with 14:45 remaining in the second half. Shawan leads DSU 21-14.
And that's exactly what we wanted them to do early on is stop that run. 2-yard gain is a win for the Hornets because Lee was averaging 8 yards per carry and everybody else was averaging 5 yards per carry as well. So good job by the Hornets to start off.
Great job by the D-line starting to impose their will. Dixon and shotgun again. We've seen a lot of that today. Looks to his left. Thought about it. It's not going to throw it. Goes back to the middle. And the pass is caught by number 10, Kane Lombard, who had a touchdown earlier in the game. And the Hornets give up about another 2 yards there. And we're at a 3rd and 3. Gain of 5 with 14 minutes remaining.
Good job by Harris flying to the football because of – the Hawks were able to get somebody in space and make somebody miss, but Harris was there to clean up the mistake, making it 3rd and 3. Let's see if they can get the ball back and force this 3-and-out.
Hornet defense looking to get a 3-and-out stop here. Dixon in the shotgun, hands it off, and that's going to be a 1st down and more. And that's going to be number 11, Marcus Hampton, on the carry and took a few Hornets with him on the drive.
They know the run's coming, so they need to bring more people in a box to guard that. Their corners have done a good job in the second half with one-on-one cover, so have faith in them. Stack the box and force them to make that pass. Force them to make a play through the air. They did not do that on that play right there. Now, another 1st down for the Hawks.
1st and 10 for Shawan. Ball at the 43. 13 minutes remaining. Bounces left, cuts back, has some room. Takes on about 300 defenders and wins. Marcus Hampton on a good carry. It looks like Shawan is trying to run the ball this half, Derek.
Starting to see these missed tackles that you saw in the first half. Arm tackles rarely bring down running backs. They have to wrap up and drive these running backs to the ground. And if they miss on the edge, then they really get beat, as you saw on that one.
Shawan now starting to move the ball. Ball at the 49-yard line. A new set of downs. And Dixon comes out in a pistol. And they may try to keep this horse out of the barn by running the football here. And they do. Bounces left. Has some room. Blockers ahead. Keeping it moving. He's keeping running. And Marcus Hampton with another big game, Derek.
Once again, they're not setting the edge. They're crashing too far in and losing contain on the outside. And that got beat for another big gain. They're bringing pressure, but they have to be disciplined on their contains on which lane you're running to. If you get too far out of your lane, things like that happen.
The Hornets definitely have to try to get some pressure and contain that run and set the edge as they got another 1st down as they move the ball to the 32-yard line, 12:30 remaining in the 3rd quarter. They switch it up this time and go in the middle, and it's nothing there. Reginald Williams, no gain on the play, set up 2nd down.
And that was a good job there by Abdul Rahman, finishing off the job, forcing a second and nine.
Second and nine, ball on the 31. Shawan has run the ball effectively. Now they get back to that motion. Another run by number 11, Marcus Hampton, and another big gain, and sets up a third and about two for Shawan.
These runs to the left, maybe they have something that they saw in the first half that they wanted to go at. Maybe a weak link on that left side of the line because they're running right at them and getting a lot of gain.
Third and 10, the defense will definitely look to dig in here and get a stop. Ball on the 24-yard line, 11:25 remaining. Shawan up 7, 21-14, looking to add points to their lead. Dixon takes the snap, takes it himself, gets up the middle, and that ball is taken away. And that's going to be a fumble picked up by the Hornets. He has some room. That's Rashawn Barrett. He's running, caught from behind by number 84. Torrey Baker, and Derek, this Hornet defense, third takeaway of the day.
And I look, did Barrett force the fumble? Or I don't know what happened there, but great job of having active hands. And actually, it was Sherrod, the guy we've been talking about. We've been saying he's the guy who has to step up. He's the guy, the only starter from that line from last year that has to make a play. And Sherrod stripped the ball loose, and Barrett, who's been flashing on the screen on some corner blitzes, was on the spot for the recovery. And another turnover for the Hornets.
And that was the essential definition of a takeaway there, ripping that ball right out of Dixon's grasp. And the Hornets have the ball at the 19, first and 10, 11 minutes remaining. They have a chance to tie this game up. And Obado comes out in the I formation. Carrier's going to go to Jackson. Jackson runs right. Gets a gain of about 3, second and 7 upcoming.
Just going back to that takeaway and how aggressive this team has been since the second quarter and putting their offense in prime position to make something happen. They scored on their last possession when they had a chance like this. Once again, they score again, and it's a brand new game, 21-21.
Obado at the 20. Toss to Jackson, runs left, gains another two or three, and set up a third and manageable. Derek, what do you do here?
I would look for Ghost in the slot again, especially down here where he can just make a catch, get on the ground for that touchdown like he did on the last possession. Let's see if they look for him. No safety can guard him. They have a safety on him. Nobody can guard him.
Obado and the shotgun. Third and 6 to go. Ball at the 15. Obado takes the snap. Looking right. Going to the end zone for Golston. Out of the grasp of Golston. Incomplete pass. Well, Derek, he went back to Golston.
And he had him. Just miscommunication. Golston turned to the outside. The pass was to the inside. If they were on the same page, that's a touchdown.
Well, it looks like they're going to take the 3 points here. Try to cut it to 21-17 and see what happens here in the rest of the game with the defense ability to take away the ball. They definitely have a lot of confidence and faith in them. It's going to be a 32-yard attempt here for NuzZD. Kick is up. Kick is good. And that cuts the lead to 4, Derek. And just like that, the Hornets are right back in this game.
That's still a small victory for the Hawks to not give up a touchdown. But it's good to see the special teams get something. Last year, that would have been a blocked field goal recovered for a touchdown for the Hawks. But they've cleaned that up so far this season. And it's really, really huge in close games like we have here.
Well, the Hornets took the lead, 21-17. 9:59 remaining in the third quarter, Derek. So, Derek, this defense has got the momentum, taking the ball away. What does Shawan do on offense to try to combat that?
I think they're just trying to figure a way to just hold on to the football. That's what's killing them. They're putting their defense in bad situations. And sometimes they're just giving up straight points to the to the Hornets defense, like we saw early in the second quarter. So they have to do a better job of holding on to the football, not try to get all of the yards. Getting 4 or 5 yards is better than a fumble. Sometimes they get 4, then get greedy and not go down. And then, like you saw, the ball gets tripped out, recovered by the Hornets, and now they're only down 4.
Well, the Hornets will kick the ball off to Shawan. Shawan hasn't really been the They started off good that last drive, but turned the ball over, as we saw with the Hornets early on in the first half. But the Hornets definitely picked up the slack there. Three turnovers on the day. And the Hornets are right back in this game. Down 4 points with plenty of time remaining. Wisdom's kick is out of bounds, and you don't want that there. Of all things to kick it, definitely don't want to kick it out of bounds.
Especially the way the defense was playing and getting the ball back for their offense. Don't put them in a bad situation. Just get the ball in the field to play. But he's been doing a good job kicking for the most part. That's the first mistake he's had. Had a lot of touchbacks in the first half, so just shake that one off.
So, Shawan will get the ball at the 40. And the Hornet defense that is on fire. Three takeaways. Definitely looks to try to maybe make another one. Here as Dixon and the offense comes back out. We'll see what Shawan can do here. Seems like the defense of the Hornets has found a way to contain that offense. Shawan relied heavy on the running game in the last drive. We'll see what they do here. Ball on the 35-yard line, first and 10. Dixon in the pistol formation, two receivers to his left, one at the bottom of the screen. Ball is handed off, and there's really 1 yard gain there by Marcus Hampton. Derek, the defensive line, is ratcheting up the pressure.
These linebackers are starting to be aggressive and run downhill. These defensive ends are starting to get into the backfield, and the running game is starting to look a little anemic for the Hawks.
Hornets are dialed in on defense. Second down and 9, 36-yard line is the spot of the ball. Dixon in the shotgun. Hornets may look to bring some pressure here. They do, but it's a wide open man. Ball gets to him. Tackle is missed. He's got some room in front of him. He's running. He's still on his feet, and that ball is completed to number 18, Damian Ellis, on a big gain there in the Hornets secondary. Gave up a big play there, Derek.
Mark Flakes has to do a better job taking a better angle at that to make a play. And Ellis was able to just make a huge gain. It should have been just a 9 to 10 yard completion. You got to wrap up when you're out there 1-on-1.
Looks like the Hornets were in the zone there, and he found a soft spot in that zone. And a lot of missed tackles today we've seen by this Hornets secondary has come back to bite them as they're at the 31-yard line as we approach 9 minutes remaining in the third quarter. First and 10 for Dixon in the offense. Ball is handed off, and there's no gain. He probably lost a yard there, and great penetration there by the defensive line of the Hornets.
Good job by Sherrod anticipating the snap count, and you see that speed. You see why he was a tight end and how that speed translates for him as he was able to get from the backside of that play to make a tackle for a loss.
Hornets defensive line knows if they get a shot at it, they have to make the tackles, and the penetration on that side has been excellent, and we've seen Sherrod show a full repertoire of the defensive line today. Second and 12, ball at the 33. Dixon in the shotgun, takes the snap. Handoff is given to number 29. He gapes up the middle. And that's a big game for Reginald Williams. And that's going to be another first down for Shawan as they're in the red zone.
And the offensive line did a good job on that play, getting up to the second level and making a block to knock Harris down, which allowed that gaping hole in the middle.
Shawan in the shotgun. Ball at the 10, at the 20, excuse me. Dixon takes it. Keeps it himself. And gets a gain of about three, maybe four. As it'll set up second down and 7 at the 16-yard line for Shawan. Shawan in the pistol. Dixon gets the snap. Hands it off to his left. Gets to the outside and stiff arm. And that's going to be a big gain there. Marcus Hampton. Gain of about 7 yards. set up a third and manageable here for Dixon in the offense of Shawan as they try to punch it in the end zone and answer the Hornets. Field goal. Third down and three, 7 minutes remaining. Hornets defense looking to dig in here and hold them to three. As Shawan looks to get that touchdown to make this an 11-point game. Dixon takes the snap. Pressure from the Hornets. Screen pass. And it is wrapped up and stopped by the Hornets defense, Kane Lombard. And they're saying he was down by contact, fumble on the play. Well, Derek, the defense rose to the occasion there.
Yeah, Sherrod's starting to flash off on the field, and that's why he's one of the better players on his team. He just has so much speed that he's able to really get out there and impact the play, even if it's not on his side. Great job there, tracking down a receiver and making a tackle and almost forced a fumble.
Now they'll set up for a field goal attempt. Nick Hahula. Kick is up, and it is good. Hahula extends the lead. 24-17, excuse me. 5:58 remaining in the third quarter.
But it's a good stop by the Hornets. They have to do a better job stopping those inside runs. And they have to do a better job of containing on the outside. But to force them into a field goal, it's okay. They can live with that. Offensively, this is going to be the first time in a while that they're getting the ball back, and it's not from a turnover. So now they're going to have to march down from the 30 or the 40 or wherever they get the ball from instead of being in a red zone because of a turnover. So we get to see if this offense can make some adjustments that we didn't see in the first half. Can they move the ball down the field on their own without the help of the defense?
So 5:58 remaining. Hornets shown signs of life. Defense has helped a lot with that. It'll be interesting to see how the rest of this game plays out. Well, it looks like we're headed for an exciting finish here with the Hornets. Shawan ready for the kickoff. Up seven. As we're under 5 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Scott will take the kick. Runs left, has some blockers. Gets out past the 35, up to about the 37, 38. And that's where the Hornets will set up shop.
Good return. And Scott's having to take some weird bounces that we talked about, but he's doing a good job fielding them and turning them into some positive yards. Good return once again on the left side there. It seems they're having some type of block formation that's allowing him to get to the edge easier than it normally should be.
Well, Obado and the offense. Chance to tie this game up with a touchdown. See what the Hornets do here offensively. Do they try to go back to that running game that has shown some flashes today? Obado, play action. Goes to the slot, and it is picked off by number nine. Excuse me. That's going to be number eight, Terrell Safford. Saffold. And now the ball will be at the 38 for Shawan.
It wasn't the best pass, but that's a pass that has to be caught. And just looks like Ortiz just couldn't get a handle on it and ended up being an interception. Huge, huge turn of events here for the Hornets that were gaining momentum and had a chance to finally tie this game up. Now on the defense, can they bail them out again?
This would be a Herculean effort if the defense can somehow not give up any points here and possibly even get another takeaway. Dixon in the offense, ball at the 24-yard line, and now that first down. Dixon gives the ball off, and it is stopped. Great penetration there. Number 29, Tarik Colston, Dirk.
And he's one of the best safeties in the MEAC, as you can see. He can do a lot of different things, cover, tackle, and good job. I like bringing him down in the box to stop the run because that's what's been hurting the Hornets the most. Bring your best player down there to help out and eliminate the run game, make this team more one-dimensional.
Second and 11, loss of one on the last play. 5 minutes remaining, ball on the 25. Hornet defense, this defensive line is ratcheting up the pressure. Corners come up tight to play press. Dixon, pass is caught. Looks like that's going to be a great timing route there. Kane Lombard on the reception. That's just a great route there, Derek.
And too clean of a pocket there for Dixon to just make a decision with the pass. They have to get pressure on these passing plays. That's how they were able to force turnovers in the first half, by bringing those pressures, corner blitzes, linebacker blitzes, something to get this guy a little rattled and throw a bad pass.
That's going to set up third and a one at the 15-yard line. 4:40 remaining here in third quarter. Dixon in the shotgun, three wide receivers, gets the snap, hands it off to Hampton. Hampton gets the carry, and the question is he have enough for the first down? Looks like he may be a little bit short. And they may call for the chain gang. And it's like, nope, they're moving the change, I believe, and they're giving him the first down.
The offensive line just got enough of push to get a couple yards there. And now we're in the red zone. Can the Hornets make a stop here?
That is the question that we will have the answer to shortly. Dixon in the shotgun, man in motion. Handoff is given to Hampton again, and that's going to be a gain of about 2 yards. Hornets trying to stop another scoring possession here by Shawan. It seems their offense has gone back to the running game a little bit more and gone to more balance. Dixon in the shotgun. Hampton to his left. Snap goes to Dixon. He's going outside. Has a man, and that's going to be incomplete. Looks like it was intended for number six, Anthony Elliott. Well, Derek, defense got to stop there.
Good job by bringing some pressure, but a good job by the offensive line picking it up and giving Dixon enough time to make that pass just a little too far out. He had his man, but didn't give him enough space on the sideline.
Well, that'll set up third down and six at the 9 yard line. Third and goal, excuse me, at the 9 yard line. Dixon takes the snap. 24 runs left, cuts back right, and he trips up, almost had a touchdown. Anthony Prince had a clear path to the end zone, and he looks like he needs some new cleats, and it'll be first and goal for Shawan.
Just some missed tackles in the backfield. That's hurting them. They're finally guessing which play the run is going to, but they got to bring them down, especially when you bring all those people at them. Nobody got to them. Almost gave up the touchdown.
Well, we got a first and goal, 3 minutes remaining. Shawan leads Delaware State 24-17. Can the Hornets dig in and make a goal line stop? That is the question here. And how will Shawan try to finish this drive? But it's still with the run, which seems to be working for them as they come out in a shotgun. Dixon and Hampton in the backfield. Lombard in motion. Handoff is given, and it is waiting for the signal from the refs. And it looks like he's going to be a little bit short, about at the half-yard marker. So you talk about inches. Shawan will have a shot here for the instant touchdown with a few feet.
Basically, I guess if you're the Hornets, you got to make an all-out blitz or something, but this is a very difficult situation for them at the one-inch yard line.
Not much you can do as a defense. Just hope that you can somehow get through one of those gaps, maybe make a fumble. Shawan still comes out in the shotgun, even with that about of space left. Dixon gets it. Going to hand it off, and it's going to be a touchdown. And Shawan scores. Marcus Hansen on the carry. Didn't have far to go, and he got the job done there. Shawan now leads 30-17.
And now the Hornets offense, they have to help out this defense that's fought so hard in these last two quarters to get this team back into it. They have to make something happen on their own for once because it hasn't worked so far.
Well, Derek, after such a great ending to the first half, the Hornets defense in the second half seems to just be getting gashed by the running game of Shawan. Nothing spectacular, nothing that is tricking them as you saw in the first half, but just ground and pound, running the ball to the left, running to the right, running into the middle. And what do you think they have to do here as we get ready for the PAT?
The offense has to score or something. They have to keep this Hornets defense from having to always bail them out. And that turnover really just hurt them because the Hornets just forced a field goal after a short field. And then on a very first play, it's another interception. And they're right back on the field again.
Kahula will attempt the point after. As it looks like we have an injury for the Hornets, number 32, Anthony Gamble. And the kick is up, and the kick is good. 31-17 is the score, 1:49 remaining, Derek. Game's not over yet, but the Hornets have to make something happen on offense, as you stated.
Exactly, and the last time they went with the play action, but nobody picked up the defensive end, and it forced Obato into a bad throw. The offensive line needs to give Obato a clean pocket for him to make these passes. And he needs to be more accurate as well because a couple possessions ago, of course, he missed Malik Golson for the touchdown, which would have had this game tied up at 24 apiece. So everybody on the offense has to be accountable. The offensive line has to give him time. Obado has to make the right decisions, and these receivers have to be able to get open. It's only been Golson in terms of getting open so far.
And real quick, I think we've seen the receivers have a tough time being able to create separation from the defense. What do you think they have to do to somehow change that?
Normally, to create separation, maybe bunch them up and run some pick plays to get each other open, but we haven't seen too much of that. Basically, the offense is relying on them to beat their man one-on-one, which they should be able to do. You should be able to beat your player one-on-one. That's how you're supposed to win these games, but we just have not seen it.
Well, Shawan will kick off to the Hornets. Scott back deep. Maybe he can make a big play here. Try to give some life back to this Hornets. Crowd was alive. It seems as though they're waiting for a play as well. Hula has had a busy day. A lot of kickoffs because of the 31 points that Shawan has put up, he has earned his scholarship today. Kick is deep inside the 10. Scott gets it. Scott takes it, runs left, goes back right, runs right, makes the guy miss, throw on his feet, spins, and gets the ball to about the 30-yard line, excuse me, and the Hornets will set up shop there.
This time they decided to kick it to the right because the Hornets were exposing them on the left side and Scott was picking up a lot of yards. But still, he was able to get the ball out to the 29-yard line. Can the Hornets make something happen? That's what we're asking for. The defense can't always give you the ball at the 10-yard line for you to score. Sometimes you have to be able to move the chains and score on your own.
Obado on the offense comes out with the ball on the 30. Comes out in the shotgun. Three receivers. Takes the snap. Looks left. Thought about it. Takes it back out. There's going to be a flag. Probably will come back for holding. Has a man, and that pass was almost intercepted. But this play will be taken back as a hold will be called.
He had his man on a curl route, but he wasn't sure if he could get that ball out there to Golson on a left side, because the corner didn't really give him a whole lot of space, force him to hold that ball too long, which leads to the holding play. But also, after the flag, you know it's a holding. Why are you taking a shot which could have been picked off? You knew the play was coming back. You saw the ref throw the flag right at you. I don't understand why Obado took that risk on that play.
Hornets are definitely trying to make something happen here. Penalty definitely will set them back. First and 20 on the 20-yard line. As we're at 1:30 remaining in the third quarter. Obadu takes the snap, runs it to his own guy, and that'll mess up the play before it even gets started. And, Derek, you can't have instances like that happening when the game's already getting out of hand a little bit.
And also, Obadu looks hurt. He's limping around because of it on that last play. Last couple plays has been leading up to him limping, got hit on a play before, and now this. He's don't want to see you running into your quarterback like that. Definitely communication problems, which is something we've seen, especially in the first half. Thought that we got that for the Hornets, got that figured out.
Second and 19 on the 21-yard line. Third quarter is getting ready to come to an end, but still have about 50 seconds remaining. Obadu gets it. Throws it in the middle, and I don't know where that was thrown to. Golston was wide open, and Obadu just missed it.
That's a throw he has to make. The snap was a little bit low, but he was able to catch it cleanly and had Golston in the slot open. He could have still been running if he had that completion there. So, the third and 19, this is not what we wanted. We talked about third down conversions by getting a little bit on first, getting a little bit on second to make this easier. They have not done that.
Well, this will set up third and 19 with 45 seconds remaining. Ball on the 21. Hornets have to make some sort of play here to get this first down. If not, Shawan will get another shot on the offensive side of the ball. Badu fumbles the snap, and he's going to fall on it. And that will be a fourth down punt, forthcoming. Not the way you want to do it on the offense there, Derek.
I know Badu really looks hurt. That leg is bothering him a lot. He wasn't able to really recover that football. You can see him limping off the field. Don't really have too much depth behind him, so he might have to play through it, but that might have been part of the reason why he fumbled the football and couldn't get it back to make any play. But it was 3rd and 19 anyway, hard to make anything happen. Fortunately, he was able to pounce on the football and they were able to punt.
Could have been worse, like you said. It could have been a turnover, but at least they live to fight another down, and they'll punt the ball. McGayu and the special teams unit. As that is going to be the end of the third quarter here at Alumni Stadium. Shawan leads DSU 31-17. Well, Derek, I don't think we saw this score coming. But, Derek, what is there left to do for the Hornets with 15 minutes on the clock?
They still have enough time, maybe 2, 3, maybe 4 possessions left, depending on how the defense holds up on their end. But they have to get something going. They can still employ a couple runs here and there, but the ball's going to have to be in the air the next time they get the ball. So hopefully the Hornets defense can force a 3-and-out and get them the ball quickly, or even better, get a turnover and get them in good position again.
Well, Derek, when you're down 14 points essentially, what is there that you can do to somehow right the ship?
Well, we saw in the first half when they were down 21. They forced a lot of turnovers, and they made a comeback in the second quarter alone. They have all the fourth quarter to play. The defense has to believe, because it's all on them to make something happen, because the offense hasn't really played very well. They have to force some turnovers or force some 3s-and-out, and the special teams might have to make a play when they get a chance. They have to help this offense, because the offense still just looks a couple of pages behind the rest of the team.
Well, McGee will try it again. They'll punt from the other end of the field, from their own 14. As we got 15 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, Hornets trail 31-17. Shawan is coming here and showing they're capable of playing with a D1 caliber program, and they play well as well. Looks like we're ready to get the fourth quarter started here. McGee will punt. Low kick, but it'll take a bounce. Ball is picked up by number 18, and he fumbles. And the Hornets get that turnover, and I think it's the Derek Slayton good luck charm, because Damian Ellis fumbles and is recovered by the Hornets.
That's a special teams play we were hoping for. There is a flag on a play. It looked like it was going to be a hold, though, so hopefully the ball remains for the Hornets. And that's one of the good plays there. The kick returner was loose with the football, a clean tackle, knocked him down, and Randolph was able to recover the football.
Well, Derek, hopefully the penalty doesn't erase the fumble, but I think you just said special teams or defensive turnover, special teams play, and you got it right on cue. What were you thinking going through that last play that led you to that Nostradamus-esque allowance of predicting the play?
It's something they've done in the last couple of years is forced turnovers on a special teams or the defense is how they've been able to win games in the past. So just hoping that they were able to do that there and they were able to make something happen. And good awareness to recover the football by Randolph. It's not always very easy to pounce on a football that just moves so oddly because of how it's shaped. And good job by the Hornets there, not giving up, still playing with just maintaining their discipline and maintaining their commitment on the lanes when they run the special teams, and a solid tackle forced a fumble.
We get a new quarterback inserted into a receiver, excuse me. You get Gilbert Rivera outside with Obadu in the game. I don't know what they're doing here, Derek, but it's interesting to see.
Rivera started a few games last season because Obadu was hurt, but he wasn't terrific in terms of passing, but they have him out there wide. Let's see if they run some type of trick play or just use that as a distraction and go to the other side of the football field. Let's see what happens here. If I'm the Hornets, though, I do move him in motion just for some type of distraction, even if the play is not going to him.
So we have Air Scott at quarterback. We have Rivera wide out of receiver. So we could have a little trickery of their own here by the Hornets. Trying to get that spark back in the offense. Scott, a high school quarterback during his time in Harrisburg. Scott keeps it, runs up the middle, tough physical yards. It's going to take the whole crew of Shawan defenders. And he gets a good gain of about four, maybe five on the play. What do you think about that play, Derek?
Makes me wonder, where's Obadu at? Is he hurt? Because they took him out and went with that option run there. Hopefully he's healthy. Is he out there? I don't see him. I think they're going to have Rivera out there for the remaining game.
Looks like Rivera will be that guy. We did see a little bit of him last year. And we'll see if he's matured and gotten better as a passer. They need him now more than ever. Second and six on the 47. Takes the snap. Looks right. Throws right. Has Ortiz in the middle. Good check down. Safe pass. It sets up a third and one. Manageable third down conversion here.
And they will have some opportunities because whenever a substitute quarterback comes in, you know the blitz is coming. You know they're going to have one-on-one man coverage on the outside and pressure's coming. He needs to be composed and get that ball out quickly or take a shot one-on-one and throw the ball accurately.
Rivera in the pistol. Hands it off to Jackson. Jackson runs left, has some room. Runs left, has a block ahead of him. Eric Scott with a block. Jackson has a clear red carpet to the end zone. He has reservations for six. Jamal Jackson on a touchdown. What a play there by the Hornets. And there's that spark that we talked about, Derek.
And terrific block by Scott on the outside to allow him to go all the way home. Great blocking all around. Good play call. They had the unbalanced line on the left side and allowed them to go all the way to the end zone. Great run by Jackson as well.
Well, Derek, talk a little bit about the blocking. A lot of people don't realize it's all about not only the offensive line, but the receivers blocking downfield as well. Eric Scott did a great job there.
Exactly, and we talked about they were going to bring pressure and they're going to have a lot of people playing man coverage and nobody, no safety help or anything. So if you can get past that first wave of defenders, there's nobody back there. All the safeties were up, all the corners were up, all the linebackers were up, and he was able to get to the outside.
And virtually untouched as well. So that's the way you draw it up as a coach if you're Coach Carter. And he drew it up to perfection there. And Jackson with the second ability to get to the second level and the speed. And this game is right back within reach for the Hornets. 31-24 is the score, 13-33 remaining, and we will be in for an exciting finish, Derek.
Also, Colson, just the do-it-all player there. He was holding on that kick. Just amazing of what he can do. Just a little versatility there for by Colson, just being a holder on that play. But can we force another turnover, it seems? It seems that's the way they're able to make things happen.
Four turnovers forced today by the Hornets. That's going to be a great tidbit for them to have, knowing this defense hasn't played their best, but they have been opportunistic and done a great job here today creating turnovers. And hopefully Derek is right, they can create another one and maybe get some points of their own and help tie this game up and go from there.
last time they were out there for the kick, it was kicked out of bounds, which led to the 35-yard penalty. So hopefully they can figure that out and just get another touchback. But the Hawks still not out on the field as they were having some conversations going on the sideline.
Hornets to kick off to Shawan. Hornets defense has to be fired up knowing they can get a three and out here. The offense has momentum. New quarterback Gilbert Rivera in. Comes in, does his job, completes the pass to Ortiz, and hands it off wisely to Jackson. Jackson gets to that second level very well. One of the better running backs in the MEAC. And his elusivity is something to watch when he gets an open field, and you saw it there. And another kick out of bounds, Derek. What is the thinking there with the kicker?
I think he's just kicking the ball so hard trying to force a touchback that he's risking some accuracy problems by doing that. And don't do that to your defense. The defense has played so well. They've made such improvement from the first half or from the first quarter on. Don't put them in a bad situation. And also now, even if they force a punt, they don't really get great field position because of it.
Be interesting to see what happens. Here, the defense is riled up. The crowd's back in the game here, Derek. Talk a little bit about what the crowd can do for a team.
Well, we saw in the second quarter when the crowd got into it, the players started forcing even more turnovers, and they were able to force three turnovers in that second quarter. They need one more. They need one more to make a play happen to tie this game back up as everybody's heading back to the sideline. A little bit of a longer break here.
So a little extended break here in between. ...31-24 is the score. 13-33 is the amount of time we have left. Rivera throwing pass on the sideline. It looks like we have a call on the field. And Shawan will have the ball at 35, first and 10. Hornets defense knows they can definitely help this team tie this game up with a good stop here. Shawan in the shotgun. Dixon hands it off, gives it off to Hampton. I think the defense of the Hornets knew was coming. He only gets a gain of one. So I have second and nine at the 37-yard line.
And the Hawks would love nothing more than to have an 8 or 9 minute possession drive. Hornets cannot allow that. They are going to have to make some plays in the run game and wrap up whatever they're in space. And let's see if that can happen here so they can force a three and out.
Second and eight on 37, fumble snap. Dixon still throws it, and that is going to be loss of a few yards there. Third and 12, ball on the 33, and this Shawan D offense is just falling apart here.
Yeah, this is a team that's lacking confidence because everybody's fumbling the ball and turning the ball over. They have four turnovers on a game, and they're just nervous about the situation. This is a huge win for them if they can hold on. And they know that, and some pressure starts to creep in.
Great point there. Third and 12, ball on the 33. 12:40 remaining. Shawan leads 31-24. Dixon in the shotgun. Has a max protection ability to protect against the blitz. Has time, throws it. Picked off almost by Tariq Colston. And Derek, he almost made a play there, and their punt, though.
If he caught that, that's a touchdown. That would have been his fifth touchdown of his career. He read it perfectly. The ball floated up there, and just took his eyes off it a little bit because he saw the end zone in front of him. That would have been huge, would have tied the game up. But a great three and out by the defense. The offense needs to make one more play happen. Can they do it with Obedo injured and Rivera in the game?
Your guess is as good as mine, and ideally time will tell, Derek. And it'll be fun to watch to see what happens. Punt is a high end over end kick, and Scott will fair catch. He'll get the ball at about the 29, and that's where the Hornets will set up shot. Rivera has the ball in his hands. And it'll be up to him to see if he can take the ball down and tie this game up.
Would like to see if they play man-to-man, a quick slant route. Hopefully he can make somebody miss, maybe Ghost and make somebody miss and take it to the house. If they play that man coverage, zero coverage blitz that they've done in the past with Rivera in the game.
As you get a shot there, Gabriel Sherrod on the ground in pain. That is a big loss if he cannot return to this game, especially with his defensive ability to put pressure on the quarterback. First and 10, ball on the 30. Rivera in the out formation. Gives it off. Jackson cuts inside. Gets gained about 3 yards. Now set up second and 7 at 27-yard line as we're approaching 12 minutes remaining. Hornets trail 31-24.
Since Rivera came into the game, we've seen 3 runs and only 1 pass. Does Carter have enough trust in him in the game on the line? Of course, there's still a lot of time remaining, so you can run the ball to put him in better situations. But can Rivera make the play? Can Carter give him the trust in him to make a play?
Rivera looks like he's in a throwing formation now in a shotgun. 2 receivers, Air Scott to his right. Jackson in the backfield. Jackson in motion. Snap. It's given off. Najee Jackson running. Gets a big gain, and I think that's going to be enough for Delaware State University Hornet. First down.
Good job of blocking on it, setting the edge on the outside. This offensive line has done a great job since the second quarter of making something happen for both the passing game and the rushing game. They're dominating up front.
Rivera, I formation, offense picking up the tempo. Ball is given to Jackson. Jackson tries to find the crease. Gets nothing but about maybe 2 yards, and that'll set up second down and 8. Ball at the 46. 11:25 remain.
It's a situation if you're the Hornets, do you call a quick passing play because you know the box is going to start to be filled with 7 or 8 players to stop the run? Let's see what happens.
Rivera, shotgun formation. Golson in motion, left to right. Rivera gets it, sprints out, throws it, and it's just out of the hands of the outstretched Bryson Allen. A little bit of the pressure there getting Rivera off his spot.
Exactly, but also Allen kind of stopped running. He kind of just stopped his feet, which led to the overthrow. He had some space because they're going to bring pressure on basically every play to try to force a turnover.
Big third down here for Rivera in the offense, 3rd and 7. Ball on the 46. This is the type of play that can define a game and see where the outcome will go. Will the Hornets keep the ball moving? Golson in motion again. This may look a lot like the same play we just saw. Rivera gets it, goes to his right. Pass was read all the way and almost picked off.
He had Air Scott wide open in the middle of the field and just never took his eyes off of Golson for the pass. That's a play you have to look, you have to read your progressions. Scott was wide open, would still be running if he had that football in his hands.
Well, it looks like the Hornets are going to punt wisely, try to pin them inside their own 20. And they still have 11 minutes remaining and only down a touchdown, so they will definitely have a chance at getting the ball back.
But that last possession just reminds you how important that dropped interception was, how crucial that play was. Tarik Colson could have tied the game up if he held on. And the defense, they're going to have to make a play because they're without their starting quarterback, and it's hard to move the ball without your starting quarterback for any team.
Wrong, good day. Maybe it's a timeout, maybe? Delay a game, looks like, on the Hornets. So they'll just give them more space to punt with.
It'll give them more space to punt and try to pin them inside the 10-yard line. It's not a huge call there. And you definitely don't want to burn a timeout in the fourth quarter for a delay of game on a fourth down. So not too big of a deal.
Want to give McGee one of your better players, especially on the special team side, as much run to work with as possible and see if he can definitely try to spiral one inside the 20. McGee, you get it. Punt is high up. And it takes a Hornet bounce inside the 20 to about the 16-yard line. So he does a job there.
And it would have been great if when he was falling, he tipped the ball. And it would have been a fumble. That would have been the perfect situation. Unfortunately, it didn't work out that way. But good punt at the 16-yard line. The defense finally isn't backed up against the wall trying to make a play. So hopefully they can force another 3 and out, a quick punt or a turnover would be the best case scenario, of course.
Yeah, you heard a big collective gasp throughout the stadium wondering if he did touch that ball, because that would have been an easy 6 points for the Hornets, and that would have been a gift. But Hornet defense has a shot again here, and we'll see what they can do. Dixon comes out again in the shotgun, and we'll see if this Hornet defense can dig in and get another stop, possibly another turnover, dare I say. Dixon, four wide receivers, 84 in motion. Dixon hands it off, and that's going to be a big hole up the middle. Number 11, Marcus Hampton, rumbling, bumbling, and gets another first down for Shawan, and that's a great way to start the drive.
Not the best start of that possession for the Hornets, and they ran right up the middle, right up the center there, and had nobody near him for about a good 15 yards.
Shawan with the first down on that first play. 10:35 remaining. Ball on the 34-yard line. Man in motion. Dixon throws it wide open. He has a man, and that ball is caught, and he's still running, ladies and gentlemen. And the Delaware State University defense finally brings him down. Big gain there, and Shawan makes a play. Anthony Elliott on the play.
And that is a terrific call by Place there. We have not seen the option pass yet. They've done a lot of option runs and even a couple pitches, but the pass had everybody fooled there, and now they're almost in field goal range.
And now they may definitely look to go back to that run game, try to establish the time of possession and try to run some time off the clock. Let's see what happens here with this team. Dixon will come out in the shotgun. They've been in shotgun all day, ladies and gentlemen. They love to run that shotgun space to field out. Dixon takes the snap, hands it off. Runner's going to go to the left. Going to be a gain of about 3 yards. Nothing more, nothing less. And that's going to go to Marcus Hampton on the carry.
And I know the Hornets want to force a turnover, but whenever a run play happens, they just have to wrap them up and bring them to the ground. If they're going to keep ripping at the football and not get it, they're going to give up a lot more yards. They just need to hold them to a field goal.
We approach 9 minutes remaining. Second and seven, ball on the 23. Dixon in the shotgun. Hands it off again, and gain of about one. He tripped up there. Hampton is, and the Hornets do a great job again stopping the run.
Great tackle by Harris there, because if he doesn't make that one, that might be a 10-yard gain.
It's a big third down here for the Hornets. Third and five. 18:50 remaining. 31-24. Shawan has come into this alumni stadium on Hall of Fame Day. Definitely made a statement as a CIAA team, showing they belong with the big boys. And they have a shot at possibly getting more points and trying to win this game. Dixon, three wide receivers. Two running backs in the backfield, probably for a max protection look. Hornets may try to bring some pressure. They do. Fake. Dixon is going to be bought down. And guess who, ladies and gentlemen? Gabriel Sherrod with a sack on a play. He's eating quarterbacks for breakfast.
Great job not falling for the play action there, and brought him towards the edge of their ability to kick a field goal here, just inside the 30-yard line. Let's see if their field goal, if they'll go for the field goal. Just kind of debating about it right now.
What do you do as a coach here, Derek?
I think you kick it. I think you go for the field goal. You make it as a two-possession game. And that's exactly what you want with just under 8 minutes remaining. The time's still running for some reason, though, so let's see what happens there. I thought a timeout was called or something.
Well, it was a sack, so I guess the play will keep going. As you see, the play clock's down to 2-1, and it looks like they will call a timeout. So they took every second there to think about it, plus the timeout. But I think that even if you don't make the field goal, the Hornets have to go all the way back down the other side of the field to get a touchdown and score and tie this game up.
Exactly. It's not a situation that the Hornets are great at right now at the 30-yard line. Whether they make or miss, you know, the Hornets, they're not that great at scoring without having some type of defensive assistance to get them down the field.
Will be interesting to see how Hula will do, as he's been a good kicker for them today. And this will be about a 40-yard attempt. So it'll be interesting to see if he can make this or if the Hornets can maybe get a block or somehow return it 4 points of their own, as we see how it will play out. Kick is up. Kick is way short, and the Hornets have an opportunity to get the ball back, Derek.
And it looks like J.R. Robinson had got a piece of it, which forced a miss, and the special teams comes up with a huge play. The defense been coming up huge. Can the offense make something happen on their own? Can they march down the field and tie this game up?
Offensively, Derek, what are you looking forward to see on this drive?
I think you want to mix the run and pass. You have to have some sort of confidence in Rivera. But at the same time, you don't want to put the entire weight of the game on his shoulders. So mix up, have a balanced attack. And also, it's a lot of man coverage. Man coverage is normally beat with a slant route or a pick route or something of that nature to free up some space for them. Let's see if they run something like that.
Rivera comes in the shotgun. We'll have to drive all the way down the field for the score. Gives it to Jackson. Jackson runs right. Makes the guy miss. Runs ahead for a gain of about five, maybe six. And I set up a manageable second down.
And we have an injury on the field. Looks like Demetri Hill is just a little slow to get up here. He'll be back at the line. Nice run by Jackson.
Well, Derek, we have second down and two. 36-yard line. 7 minutes remaining. Golson in motion. Rivera with Jackson behind him. Hands it off, and Jackson is galloped up by number 43, Dakota Bear. And he looked like a bear wrapping his arms around Jackson.
And right there, everybody was in the backfield. There was nowhere for the running back to go on that play. Now third and six, you have to put the ball in Rivera's hands. I will probably bring a tight end in the chip to block to give him some time. I wouldn't run five receivers out.
Rivera in the shotgun, third and six. We're at 6:15 remaining. Ball on the 32-yard line. Rivera looks to the sideline for the play. Aris Scott may be the target here. He does have a lot of opportunities. He is the target. Throws to him, and it is no good. No flag on the play. And just like that, a three and out.
And on that play, a lot of contact, but the pass was probably uncatchable. It was a pretty bad throw on that one. And he's not looking through his progressions. He threw an out route with two corners that jumped it. If that ball was in play, it could probably be picked off, and that would have been a game. He has to be careful with where he's putting the football at.
Like I stated, I thought the ball was going to Scott. It did, and I think the defense of Shawan knew that, and they definitely jumped that play and had an opportunity for a bigger play if they would have caught it. So McGee will continue his busy day and punt yet again and try to pin Shawan deep in their own territory. Punt is high and over end punt. Caught as it's going to be a fair catch. Ball's going to be at about the 22-yard line, and Shawan will definitely try to move the ball and try to take more time off the clock, Derek.
They have to be aware of that option pass, which almost finished the Hornets off last possession, so they can't do an all-out blitz to stop the run. They have to still be wary of that option pass, because if they complete one, that could be the game.
Well, Derek, the defense has been pretty consistent all day. Let's see what they do here. With about 5:57 remaining here, Shawan, first and 10 on the 23-yard line. Dixon hands it off, and there's a big hole in number 11, Marcus Hampton takes advantage of it, and he's close to another first down, sets up a second and one.
And luckily for the Hornets, it's not Lee out there with all that space. And early in the first half, he was the one cutting up the Hornets for – he had 80 yards before his injury. So Hampton's doing a good job, though, in his replacement, making some good rushes.
But Hampton lacks in speed. He makes for him power and girth. And you definitely see it here, being able to wear down his Hornet defense. Second and one, ball in the 32, 5:20 remaining. Dixon in shotgun. Has a man in motion to his right, number 24, George Parker. Hands off to number 11, and it is going to be Hampton again with another big game. Brings it out to about the 39.
Lee Harris had a great game so far, but on that one, I don't know what he was doing. He just kind of pushed him, did not try to wrap up or anything, and that led to the first down.
Now you see Shawan moving the ball slowly, methodically, breaking huddle real slow, taking every second on the play clock, seeing what they can do and how much time they can take off the clock, and try to get more points for this drive. So you'll see Dixon come out in a shotgun. I don't think Shawan has been out of shotgun all day. Their offense is based out of it. Pressure from the Hornets is forthcoming. Dixon gets it, hands it off again, and the Hornets are on that. Great gap coverage there by the Hornet defense, and Hampton gets no gain.
Start to wonder, when do the Hornets take some timeouts? Do you let it go all the way down, or what do you start making the timeouts? You can save an extra possession if they're able to. Start calling timeouts now, but let's see what happens.
And speaking to that point, the Hornets do have all three of their timeouts. So, like you said, Derek, do they take a timeout here? But it looks like they're going to let it play out. Second and 10, 4:16 remaining. And you see Shawan taking their time, methodically working on figuring out what they're going to do offensively. But it's an empty backfield here for Dixon. Don't be surprised to see a quarterback draw. Hampton comes back in the backfield with him. He'll probably get the carry here. Gives it to him. He does. He goes ahead, keeps those feet churning, gets a gain of about 4 right to midfield with 3:56 remaining, second and 10. And it looks like it's going to be a timeout for the Hornets, I believe.
Now that the timeout's been called, you have to make a stop here, or this clock will really start to dwindle down. So who's possession? Third and 6 is kind of that situation. Do you pass it or do you run it? Let's see what Chawan Hawks done. They've been aggressive when they need it to be. We've seen trick plays. We've seen halfback tosses. So nothing is out of the question on 3rd and 6 with the game on the line.
Well, Dark, this is one of the biggest plays of the game here. 3rd and 6 at midfield. 3:58 remaining. 31-24 is the score. Shawan is coming here and punched the issue in the mouth. The issue did recover to cut it to 7. But it will be interesting to see what happens. What do you do here as a defensive coordinator, Dark?
If I was the Hawks, I would go back to that option pass that worked. Have these guys thinking it's a run and try to throw it over the top of the Hornets defense. If I'm the Hornets, you have so many things to think about. So let's see what happens. But maybe the Hawks play conservative and just run the ball and force the Hornets to burn another timeout. That also is a possibility.
The Hornets are going to make some noise here from their crowd. They're going to hear it. Dixon comes out. 5 receivers. No running back in the backfield as of yet, but they do love that motion. That could change. 3rd and 6, ball on the 45. Shawan leaves 31-24. Dixon gets the snap. Hornets bring pressure. They're going to not get to him. He escapes, has a man wide open, and it's going to be a first down. And Shawan moves the ball. Kane Lombard, what a play there by Dixon, the composure, keeping his eyes downfield and making those guys miss.
There was some confusion on the defensive end. You saw Colson looking at the signals, trying to figure out what the play call was. Nobody knew what exactly was being called, and they almost had the sack still, but they were unable to bring Dixon to the ground.
Well, now you see the clock churn towards 3:30. Down by 7, Hornets still with 2 timeouts. Dixon in the shotgun. Ball is handed off to Reginald Williams. He gets a gain of about 2 yards.
And we'll see if the Hornets will burn another timeout. I do not think they will. Second and 9. If they can make another stop, then you burn a timeout. You still have about 2 minutes and 20 seconds remaining. So this is huge because another first down, and they're in field goal range. They have to stop them here if they want to stay in this game.
Great point. And speaking of which, the clock is approaching 2 minutes. Second down and 9, ball in the 39. Dixon may hand it off again to Williams to take some more time off the clock. Carry is given to Hampton, gain of about 2. Sets up 3rd down. Do the Hornets take another timeout here? I believe they do.
In this situation, you have to kind of think, do you be aggressive and try to knock him out of field goal range and try to force a sack or incompletion? Or do you allow a short pass to be completed and wrap up to make it about the 33 or 34-yard line for the field goal? But, of course, most importantly, they have to get off the field now.
Hornets, like you said, have to get off the field here. Third and eight. Let's switch it to Shawan. What do you do here as an offense? Do you run the ball and force him to use another timeout?
I think that would be pretty good. But at the same time, if they don't make the field goal on the other end, it's a seven-point game. So I wouldn't be against taking a shot here if they're thinking run.
Shawan with the ball, third and eight. Hornets still have one timeout remaining, 2:32, plenty of time remaining in this game. So anything can happen, and Hornets definitely know that, especially defensively. Keep an eye out for number 88, Gabriel Sherrod. He's been a force all game long on that defensive line. Dixon in a shotgun, four receivers. Dixon keeps it himself, and that was a great fake there and a big gain, about 1 yard short of first down.
That might put them in field goal range. A good play call. Haven't seen Dixon actually keep the ball on those option runs. Fourth and one. The Hawks look like they might go for it. And if they do and they get the first down, that'll be the game. But they'll probably let this clock dwindle down, call a timeout, and then decide what they want to do.
Fourth and one, the decisiveness of what do you do here as a team, as a coach, as a quarterback. So Shawan will, Delaware State will take their last timeout. Well, Derek, what does Coach Carter tell his team in this huddle?
Well, I don't know why they just took their last timeout. They let like 20 seconds dwindle down. I don't understand that. But the kick got blocked around the same area. If you're the Hawks, fourth and one, your running game's been efficient. You have a lot of different options in that running game. You have to go for it here if you're the Hawks.
I agree. They may decide to do that. Fourth and one, 1:58 remaining. Ball in the 31, so they want to win this game. They may have to take that risk. Dixon comes out, fourth and one. They're going to go for it. Hornets are out of timeouts. Two receivers to his left. Comes out in a pistol formation. So the decision will be in Dixon's hands here, probably with a read option type play. Does he keep it or does he hand it off? He's going to hand it off, and that man is stopped. And it is number 88, Gabriel Sherrod. Derek, what a game he has had today. My goodness.
It was Sherrod and also Colson who met him first and just slowed him down enough for Sherrod to finish up the business. That's what you talk about, your big-time player showing up when it matters the most. Those are the best two players on that defense showing up to make a play when it matters the most. But this is the last chance the Hornets have.
Well, Derek, we get another opportunity. Rivera will be the quarterback. 31-24, 1:57. First and 10 on the 31. Let's see what Rivera has left. Does he have the clutch gene? Rivera gets it, throws it. Scott in between the coverage. What a play there. What a throw by Rivera. And Scott is brought down at about the 35-yard line. What a play there, Derek.
Terrific play by Scott. He looks to be a little shaken up, but that is a college type of throw in between the corner and a safety in his zone there, and huge play, but they have to hurry up to the line. Unless, I think, did Scott get out of bounds because the clock has stopped?
Looks like there's a player down, which is the last thing I'm going to see for the Hornets to stop in some of that momentum. I don't know the player who's down. Is that Scott? Yep, Scott is down. He's up on his feet. They're going to take him out for at least a play. But that's a big loss, Derek, having one of your receivers out like that, it possibly for the rest of the game.
It definitely is. Doesn't look to be serious, though, and that's the biggest important thing is that he's walking with a little bit of assistance. He's not really putting pressure on that left leg, though, which is not what you want to see. I thought he was at first, but he's not. Hopefully he's okay. And but that was a terrific throw to get back into the football. Rivera showing confidence and taking a big risk there, throwing it in between a corner and a safety. But that has to give you some confidence to say, okay, maybe I can make some plays against this defense and bring my team back into for a victory.
Well, Derek Rivera with a great throw there. Looks like the Shawan defenders are going to sit back in coverage and see if he can make the tight throws in the tight windows. He made one there. Shotgun. Four receivers. Looks to his left. Looks to his right. Pressure's coming. He's going to get away. Has a man down the field. It is complete. What a play there. And it's complete to Bryson Allen. Great job there by Rivera showing his maturity, keeping his eyes downfield.
He showed maturity. He was also smart when he was rolling out to keep two hands on the football and not really even look to throw until he had a clean enough look at it. Beautiful job keeping his eyes down the field, like you said.
Rivera in this offense, keeping the tempo moving. Ball on the 22. Snap goes to Rivera. He's going to take a shot to the end zone. And there's going to be no flag on the play. He does get the flag. Looks like you'll get pass interference here, Derek.
Exactly. He was being held from the minute he got free. Allen got past his man. It looks like the call is going to be on Saffold, who was all over him holding his jersey.
As the refs adjudicating, trying to make a decision here. Well, that'll be a first and 10. Ball will be spotted at the 22-yard line. One, 10 remaining. This is definitely crunch time, or what I like to call clutch time. Excuse me, the ball will move even closer. It will move to about the 8-yard line. Ball move to the 7-yard line. First and goal at the 7. Hornets have 4 tries to get the ball in the end zone to tie this game up. 1:10 remaining. This is what games we live for here in college football. And you got one here today, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see how this one plays out. Rivera in shotgun. Jackson to his left. 4 wide receivers. Rivera has been hot on this drive. Shawan may look to bring pressure to try to rattle the quarterback. Looks over to the sideline. Gets the play. Rivera ready for the snap. Gets it. Looks left. Throws it. And it is going to be tipped by Shawan. What a play there by Dominique Fulton, Derek.
And that's just a spacing issue because Fulton dropped off his man who curled early of the end zone and allowed him to break on a route and tip a pass that would have been a touchdown if he wasn't back there.
Great play there. Second and goal, 105 remaining. Shawan, 31. Delaware State University, 24. Touchdown and field goal ties this game up. 3 wide receivers towards right. Golson in the slot. Look for him here. They're going to go to him. Had him. No. It's going to be up. What a play. A one-handed catch. What a play there. And what a catch. Jeremiah Williams on a play. One-handed. Look my one hand. Williams, what a play. And the Hornets are an extra point away from tying this game up.
That was a terrific catch there. One-on-one coverage, and Rivera just giving his player a shot at the football to make something happen. Terrific, terrific catch one-handed by Abrams for the touchdown.
Kick is good. He missed it. The field goal is missed. Whoa, Derek. There you go.
That's a poor way for a game to end right there for the missed field goal. That's a huge blow for the Hornets. I thought he made it at first and then looked at it again. Looked like it went wide right there.
Kick did look good, but it was no good. What a way to possible heartbreak for this team, Derek.
And he was doing such a good job early in the game in terms of kicking off and the extra points, and maybe the pressure just got to him. But that's a gimme. That's one he has to make. That's one he has to be confident in himself. That's just unfortunate for a game to possibly end that way.
Definitely a tough play there. So 59 seconds remaining. Do you try the onside kick here, Derek?
You have to go onside kick. There's no timeouts remaining. If they don't get this onside kick, that's basically the game here.
Well, it will probably be onside kick here for some relevance or chance for the Hornets to somehow get this ball, but Shawan will call a timeout to stop the momentum for a second.
In this situation here, normally you'll see Shawan have a line of, the first line will be the blockers, and normally the receivers will be on a second line so they can make a play here, but hopefully they can get an odd bounce to force a tip, and then anything goes after that. But this is going to be a very tough situation for the Hornets.
Well, Derek, it's kind of hard to put Washington Delaware State University football into words, but if we could, it would be that last drive and last extra point attempt.
It's always just great effort, but a little too late or a little too short, or this time is a little too far wide right. But just unfortunate. They can't hang their heads, though. They have one last shot, and it's this onside kick here.
It's like there's always an accident waiting to happen around the corner, and you just never see it coming, but then it hits you out of nowhere. But hopefully they have a chance at this onside kick here. McGee will try his onside kick. See what the Hornets do here. Ball looks like it probably was touched by the Hornets, but let's see what happens.
If they do not throw a flag, this will be a horrible call by the refs, because a Hornet touched that ball before it happened, but they're going to say it's the Hawks' ball anyway. And that will be the end of the game, most likely. They still have to run one more play.
Wow, what a play. What an ending. And Shawan gets the ball back. And this is going to be a tough one if the Shawan Hawks do hold on, Derek.
That was good execution on the onside kick to at least force a situation for the refs to have to decide who touched the ball or who has the ball at the end of the pile. But should have never came up to that. Special teams, like you said, you mentioned it. That was your one extra key to the game that you threw in there late. You said special teams is going to have to be better. They forced the turnover. They did a good job of returning. And unfortunately, just one missed extra point is all people will talk about after this game.
And just not to reminisce, but just think if Obadu didn't fumble on that possession in the first quarter, where we could be at, or how the Hornets could have the lead here.
Exactly. There's a lot of doubting coming on. Of course, you can remember Colson had his interception slip right off his hands. That would have been a touchdown. A lot of things slipped away that could have changed the momentum of the game. And you can't blame it all on the kicker as well, because this team started off down 0-21. So everybody will have to blame spread around. They made a great effort. They played hard. This crowd will definitely appreciate that, but this is a heartbreaking loss here.
And as Shawan will line up in the victory formation, the road ahead for the Hornets doesn't get any easier. We're going to take a look at the schedule. And this is a lot of heavy road games coming up as well. Next home game isn't until October 3rd, where they play Morgan. They actually have a few weeks off in between there. And then they go to Hampton, which is not going to be easy. At Florida A&M, which is never easy as well. We saw them in the last game of the year. South Carolina State home and Bethune-Cookman at home. So it would definitely be interesting to see what happens. And then they have North Carolina Central and A&T on the road in Inwood Howard. So road doesn't get any easier, especially as they get into MEAC play.
And And also, we don't know how severe the injury was of Obado. They might be out of their starting quarterback again. So it might be on Rivera to mature and grow from his last drive that we've seen and build upon that and hope that they can make something happen. But congratulations to the Showing Hawks to get this victory. A Division II team normally doesn't beat an FCS team, so this is huge for them.
Great point there, Derek. I mean, that was just an excellent game all around by them. Congratulations to their head coach, Tim Place, his staff. They got it done. I think they definitely made the plays, but you saw Coach Carter try to make the adjustments. But they seem to just be one step ahead of the Hornets at all times in this game. Even when they didn't put up a lot of points, they moved the ball, took time off the clock, and you see what happened, Derek.
Exactly, and they mixed things up. This team in the first two games did not run the ball that much. They threw a lot of passes, and they mixed it up and went heavy run, and it paid off for them, and they were able to pull off the victory. They showed a lot of good, unique formations, especially in the first half. A lot of reverses, option runs, option passes, halfback passes. He threw the whole playbook at that Hornets defense, especially in the first half, and they were able to build a big enough lead that the Hornets could never catch up.
Well, for Derek Slayton, I'm Byron Dixon. Once again, the final score. Showing Hawks 31, your Delaware State University Hornets 30. Don't forget to join us for our next telecast, which will be October 3rd when Morgan State makes a trip up to Alumni Stadium. It will sure be a fun MEAC battle. For the rest of the crew here, once again for Derek Slee, my name is Byron Dixon. Have a great night, everybody.